Apparently from an overdose of sleeping pills. Civil unrest in Mississippi as James Meredith, a black student, attempts to register at the state university. The Cuban Missile Crisis brought the world to the brink of war. Colonel John Glenn became the first American astronaut in space. Telstar, the communication satellite, was launched, and television would never be the same again. And in the newspaper headlines, amazing glut of Irish salmon, where are they coming from? EC decision on Ireland's entry within a year. And for those in the money, a Ford Anglia would have cost you £576, a four-bedroom house in Fox Rock cost £3,650, and entry to Cleary's ballroom was 6 shillings. And there was an exciting new addition to the TV listings, The Late Late Show, a new program for late viewing starring Danny Commons, Liam O'Brien, Veronica Mullen, with Gay Byrne as host. This was the TV review of the following day. With his customary aplomb, Gay Byrne ushered in The Late Late Show, and although it has not yet found its feet, it impressed me with its possibilities. That was the year that was 1962.
Ah, dear. And I can assure you he was the only one who was impressed with his possibilities. Of that, there's no doubt. Now, over the years, down through the years on the show, ladies and gentlemen, we've introduced some new acts, and many of them have gone to greater things. In 1995, this family of four were playing gigs to crowds of 200-300 people. And just 4 years later, two albums later, they've sold a staggering 10 million copies worldwide, becoming one of the most popular, and some would say, and I would agree, one of the best-looking bands in the business. And on July 17th next, they'll be in Lansdowne Road, and it's estimated they'll be playing to about 50,000 people. The last time we met them was on our beautiful Oma show, and indeed they were the brains and the inspiration behind that entire show, so it's suitable and appropriate, and they're very, very welcome to come back on this show tonight. Would you welcome, please, from Dundalk, The Corrs.
Thank you.
not a bad opener to get us going from the chorus. And thank you again for being with us. It's always lovely to see you. Now, ladies and gentlemen, when we were asking people who they would like to see on the Late Late Show tonight, one name kept on cropping up. And he's one of my favorites, so it suits us perfectly well. And he's been with us several times on the Late Show down through the years and always was great, great value for money. He can't be with us in person. He's in L.A., but would you welcome, please, Mr. Billy Connolly. Yo! How are you, Billy? And tell us why you were with us, please.
I'm here, Gay, to see the passing of a great Irish icon into the mists of that weird place where you live over in that peninsula. They're going to name it after you now, aren't they?
No news of that yet.
Peninsula.
Well, why wouldn't you be welcome on the show anytime, Billy? Because you've been here several times and you were very, very good to turn up and we always appreciated you coming. But then your grandfather emigrated from Ireland to Scotland. Have you looked into your family history, by the way?
No, well, there's very little known of it. You see, I don't know what they did wrong, but it seems to be a big secret. I think they ran away. My grandfather was 10 years of age when he left Ireland. And funnily enough, I was on your show and I said this because I was going up to Clifton in Galway where they thought he came from. They weren't sure. And a girl phoned and said she lived in my grandfather's house in Ballyconneely. So I drove up there, but I didn't have the nerve to go up to the door. I thought Ballyconneely was a lovely place. And she was a social worker and they frightened the life out of me anyway. So she would probably find something terribly wrong with me and chase me away.
So what happened?
But I had met Peter O'Toole before that. And he said, wouldn't it be weird if your grandfather came from Ballyconneely? It sounds like Billy Connolly. You know?
And do you feel Irish or Scottish, Billy?
I think I feel both. I'm kind of... I've got a dreary Presbyterian side to my nature, which is the Scottish side. And I have a sort of happy, cheery, very untidy, bad taste in clothes, which I think is Irish.
And are you into Scottish nationalism then, so far away?
I hate nationalism in all its ugly forms. I think the world is a wonderful place and there should be no frontiers at all. People should be able to come here, go there. The Irish know that. Everywhere you go, you meet an Irishman. My God, when you play Carnegie Hall in New York, it's a home game. Everybody comes from Dublin.
What about memories of your many tours in Ireland, Billy? Anything stand out for you?
Oh, I couldn't even start with memories of tours of Ireland. Do you know what I love in Ireland? They call me a bollocks. You know? You see, when you're driving along, going from town to town, and you look out the window and you catch somebody's eye, and you go, hi, and they go, oh, it's Billy Connolly. Bollocks. And one of the weirdest and funniest things that ever happened to me happened on the way to your show. You may remember this. It was years ago. It was a guy called Noel, a driver. I went into the limousine. You've always given me a nice big car to get to your show in. And the radio was on, you see. And lovely music. And I thought it was Planksty or somebody, you know. And Noel makes a dive for the radio to put it off when I come in the car. And I said, no, leave it. It's good. So we're driving through Dublin, listening to this lovely music. And it finishes. And I said to him, was that Planksty? And his answer will go to my grave with me. He said, I don't know. I don't usually work Friday nights.
Oh, dear. Billy, any chance of you taking one of your travel programs to Ireland then, just to cover all that territory and so on?
Do you know, I was desperate to do it, and I thought, well, it would be even better if Christy Moore did it. So I called Christy and I said, you know, you've got to do one of these things. You know the place at the back of your hand? Your music is really sound. You know all the great, you know, Donald Lunny and all these people who could easily do it. Because you just tell the truth, really, and go around looking at things that you genuinely like. I mean, what could be easier? But Terry Wogan jumped up and did one.
That's right.
But I thought it was a bit Aaron Sweater and you know, Shamrocky. So I think maybe we could do it. I'd love to do it with Christy. It would be a brilliant idea. I mean, there isn't a better country to tour, I wouldn't think, for stories and laughs and music.
Well, Christy is with us later on, and he'd be delighted with your remarks.
Is he? Oh, great.
Oh, yes. But coming up to middle age now, Billy, any alterations in lifestyle or whatever? I know you're not drinking anymore. Are you still off the booze?
Oh, yes, I am. Yeah, I couldn't go back and do that. Although they were lovely days. I used to come over to Dublin to get pissed, you know, at the establishment. Not the establishment, the embankment. Me and Paddy Riley getting scooshed at the bar.
But you're not
drinking
now.
As a matter of fact, Paddy Riley... No, I'm not drinking now. I remember Paddy lifting a bad pint of Guinness. And he looked at it and he says, by the high hand of Holy Jesus. To this day, I fall about when I think of it.
I loved you absolutely.
I love Ireland.
I loved you absolutely, Billy, on Mrs. Brown. You did a fantastic job and well done. What movie are you working on now? There's a round of applause for you. What are you working on now, Billy?
I'm doing some stuff. I've done a lot of films since then. Most of them I wander around killing people. I'm very dark.
Yes.
But I'm going up to Vancouver to do one with Sharon Stone.
Oh.
So I thought tonight, just for you, since you're retiring, maybe you could tell me if there's anything you always wanted to do to Sharon Stone, and I'll do it when I get there.
What's it
and
called?
I'll write and tell you all about it.
What's it called? Beautiful Joe? Are you Beautiful Joe?
I'm not telling you.
Why
because
not?
Because there's two Joes in it. Well, I'm Joe in it. So you can think I'm Beautiful Joe.
Fantastic. Well, Billy...
It's easy to believe, isn't it? A man who's windswept and interesting.
No, not really. Billy, thank you very, very much for taking time off to be with us. It really is lovely. And you've been a great friend of The Late Show down through the years.
Gabo, it's a real pleasure for me. And I feel so flattered to have been asked onto your last show. You've done a grand job since 62. And let me tell you something else. I've always loved your radio show. And the work you did on the whole AIDS thing before anybody would recognize it in Ireland should be a commemoration to you somewhere. Good on you, man. See you later.
God bless you. Thank you very much indeed. Billy Connolly, ladies and gentlemen. Billy Connolly. Lovely. God bless you, Billy. Good luck to you. Now, that was nice. Now, Mike Murphy, in his usual disgraceful manner, attacked a member of our audience before we came on. Poor, unfortunate Larry Gogan. You didn't deserve it, Larry. How are you, Larry? You're very welcome. Lovely to see you. You're about to thank me for something. Is that
right,
Larry?
Yes, without you, Gay, I probably wouldn't be here at all, you know. I don't mean you're my father or anything like that. But do you remember the time we used to do Picking the Pops on a Saturday afternoon? The Late Late Show on a Saturday night.
Yep.
And then on Monday you did the 17 Club on radio.
Yep.
And then you went to the BBC and you couldn't get back in time to do Picking the Pops. And you had to leave before the 17 Club. And I got both those shows and it kind of established me as a pop DJ. So I'm ever grateful that you went away.
I opened the gates for you, Larry. Yes, but we go back further than that. We go back to the wonderful Mr. Pennypacker in the Olympia Theatre.
We did indeed.
Stanley
did you play
Isley.
My older brother?
You wouldn't say that. It's not true anyway. Stanley Isley and Leo McKay. That's as far back as
that's
we go.
That's a long, long time. We were teenagers.
Isn't it a miracle we're all still standing? Lovely to have you with us.
Thank you very much indeed.
Well, hello, Flory. Good evening to you. Jimmy McGee, where's Jimmy? Oh, there you are, Jimmy. How are you, Jimmy? I didn't realise you'd had another belt.
Braces.
You know exactly what I mean, Jimmy.
Yes,
I do. You were in again. I didn't realise that.
I'm always in. I'm 12 weeks ago today.
Yeah.
And I have recovered, I think.
Good on you. Good on you.
Yeah, still a pulse.
So your memory is of what? Of your
memory is of the special you did on the Late Late Show so splendidly on your part a decade ago. And somebody asked me recently, had I any inkling at all? And truthfully, I didn't. Because it would be, wouldn't it be big-headed of me to have thought that they'd do a special, the Late Late Show would do a special on somebody like me. But a car, they said in your office,
yes,
a car would pick me up and bring me to the show. Now, I was due to be on the show to talk cycling.
Yes.
With Sean Kelly and Stephen Roach. And a bit about travel and that sort of stuff. And I said, car? No. I'll drive down myself. No. Yeah, the car will pick you up. But I didn't know. I mean, I didn't. Why would I know? But they said, well, Gay always insists that whatever guests on the show, big or small, a car picks them up.
Yes.
That sounded plausible. So the car picked me up, and I was went up to make up, and Kelly and Roach were there. That seemed all right, too, because they were supposed to be here. And then somebody came in and said, look, one of our guests is held up at the airport. Would you mind, Jimmy, going on first? It makes no difference to me. Of course I'll go on first. And came down, and you met me and herded me in. And I looked around. And see, I know him, and I know him, and I know her. And it's my daughter, Linda, who's beside me, and I know and all of my family. And I realized that there's something more to this. And it was during the first commercial break I said to you, is this all about me? And you said, well, hang on and see.
You were a bit slow that night, Roger.
I'm always slow. As this is my last chance to say this to you and about you, did you ever know that you were one time very nearly a famous footballer? Let me explain.
No.
When you were beginning to find your feet, walking up and down the corridors and Radio Erin and Henry Street, hoping that some door would open and they'd grab you and take you in and say, would you like to do a program? Would you like to report on a hockey match? Anything. But you were on the air and you had your little swing show on that. And you were beginning. You were as good then as you are now, to be honest with you. The only thing you learn from experience is experience. And if you can't do it, you can't do it. It doesn't matter how much experience you have. But there was a guy who played fullback for Shelburne, a lad called Gay Byrne. And we used to be at the games and the fellas would be saying, is that the same fellow who does that? God, the innocence of it all.
The innocence.
And he was more famous as Gay Byrne than you were.
Yes, I was as Gay Byrne.
And here we are all those years later.
And who remembers him?
It's been a magical it's been a magical journey.
Thank you, Jimmy. Well done. Thank you. Thank you. Well done. Now, what? Yes, I have. Ladies and gentlemen, Telecom Erin, to mark the final Late Late Show, where are you, Pat? There you are. To mark the final Late Late Show, they have got out a brand new, specially produced commemorative pack. It's a call card with units on it, you see. But for the audience, it goes on sale tomorrow, and it's available to everybody. But for the audience tonight, they've done it very specially. That's me there, you see. That's a photograph. That's a photograph of me. And my photograph is also on the call card, you see. It's all very cleverly designed and thought of. And it's specially to commemorate the final Late Late Show. And there's a lovely pack for everybody in the audience. How about that? From Telecom Air. Telecom Air. So there you are. And they go on sale tomorrow for everybody. All right, we'll take a break here. Come back to us after this. Thank you. Go, 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 go. Go, go, go. Well done. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we're in the first...
Any break from the financial pressures of parenthood should come as a welcome break.
With Bank of Ireland's Baby Break, you can now take 3 months off from paying your mortgage. So you can get those buggies and playpens and walkers and all that other baby stuff. It's one more step to better banking and one less thing to keep you awake.
100Y2000 from Bank of Ireland. It's a clear improvement.
Everyone loves the taste of Hellmann's Real Mayonnaise.
Battles will press for Hellmann's. Bread is cut out for Hellmann's. Eggs are cracked for it. Ham and cheese snack for it. Food loves Hellmann's.
The rich, creamy taste of Hellmann's. It makes foods you love best taste even better.
Hellmann's has the taste you love. Food gets better when you put it all together with the bun.
Kellogg's Corn Flakes. Tumble toasted flakes of crunchy golden corn, drenched in ice-cold milk. Isn't it amazing how a simple bowl of Kellogg's Corn Flakes can help you feel good for the day? Kellogg's Corn Flakes, the sunshine way to a better day.
Time's nearly up.
The last day to register your interest in the Telecom Air and Share offer is Friday, May 28th.
Remember, registration doesn't commit you to buying shares.
But if you do register, you'll receive priority share allocation in the event of excess demand.
Plus more information and a share application form.
Call 1-800-715-111 today.
It's your chance to share in the future of Telecom Air.
Join in.
Register now.
With everyone concerned about healthy eating these days, it's good to know just how much fat is in your diet. And if you look down the scale of foods, each with their percentage of fat, you might be surprised to learn how little fat some things really contain. Like milk, which is just 3.5% fat. That's right, just 3.5%. Milk. So simple. So natural. So drink it.
The boys watch the girls while the girls watch the boys who watch the girls go by. Eye to eye, they solemnly convene to make the scene. Which is the name of the game? Watch a guy or watch a dame on any street in town. Up and down, and over and across, romance's bond.
Have you got what it takes to join our club?
Of Dairy Gold, your daily spread.
Welcome back. And we have some more reminders of the show down through the years from Paul the Rig. See how many of these young faces you recognize. Roll it there, Ray, please. Have a look. some young faces down through the years. And the little baby, just for those of you who don't remember, the little baby at the very beginning of that clip, looking very, very ill, was little Colin McStay, who appeared with his mother, and he badly, badly needed a liver transplant. And it was the first time that there was a monster outpouring of goodwill and good work around the country to raise the money to send him to America to have his liver transplant. And he grew up to be a healthy young man, and wherever he is now, just that memory reminds me to send him our very best regards and a long and healthy life to him. Now, ladies and gentlemen, you know that this game is about talking and communicating and telling people your story and so on. And if the story is of interest, people will listen to it and they'll want to hear it. But often people don't want something said and they want to censor people in what they have to say. Our next guest was with us 6 years ago. He was told not to talk, or if he did talk, he would be killed. Just that. But talk he did, and he came here under threat to the Late Late Show to tell his complete story. And 6 years later, 6 years ago on the show, he was saying that he was looking forward to the following year when perhaps he would be free to move around the world as a free person and untrammeled by threats. It hasn't happened. Would you welcome, please, Salman Rushdie. Good day, sir. Good to see you. Do sit down. Now, you're on the circuit publicising your new book, The Ground Beneath Her Feet. What is your present situation, Salman, with regard to security and so on?
Well, there is still some bit around, but I really think, you know, it's different now. There was an arrangement between the British government and the Iranian government last year when they basically removed the threats, and there is some need for continuing precautions because of splinter groups inside Iran and so on, but it's not the same as it was, and I really think finally, I seem to be getting back to, you know, to the world of books, getting off the front page and back into the literary section.
But it only needs one hothead, one daft guy, one solo
operator.
Yeah,
but you know that you can't think like that. Otherwise, you'd never cross the road, you know, in case you were hit by a car. So, I mean, my own feeling is enough already. It's beginning to feel pretty anachronistic, all that stuff.
Yes.
And you know, the world changes and moves on. And I just think, you know, the thing I can do is write my books, and so that's what I'm doing.
Yeah, but you still have security around.
There's still a bit. Yeah,
our boys are still outside looking after you tonight and so on.
Yeah.
But you don't. It's when you get complacent about it is the real danger, I suppose.
Oh, I'm not complacent about it. I just have things to do.
Okay. So you gave a talk tonight. You were down.
Yeah, I was reading. I was reading at in Temple Bar, and that was great fun. You know, I read a bit of the new book, and people seemed to like it.
Yes.
I mean, I've always felt very close to Irish writing, you know, because it was one of the things, I mean, Joyce and so on, was one of the things that taught me how to write. And I still reread Ulysses in order to learn how it's done, and don't seem to be able to do it that way, but then nobody else can either.
This is based on Orpheus and Eurydice,
yes.
The myth of, but you work in rock and roll, and you work in a rock and roll band and so on. How familiar are you with rock and roll, and where are you in it?
Well, I mean, I'm pretty familiar with it, you know, because I grew up around it. I mean, it got to Bombay, incidentally. I mean, and yesterday I was hearing that from somebody that you know, at the same time as I was listening to early, you know, Elvis and Little Richard, and my mother was trying to make me listen to Pat Boone, there were people in China also saying that they didn't understand Beethoven or Mozart, but they understood Elvis. And I think that something about rock and roll music spread across the world like lightning, at a time when the world didn't have global mass communications, which makes it even more remarkable that it did that. And so I've thought of it as like the soundtrack of my life in a way, and so it became quite a natural way of stitching together a book that looks at many different parts of the world because the music went everywhere.
And living in Bombay and from your background, it didn't seem Western to you,
no,
did it?
No, it didn't. I mean, that's in retrospect, it's very odd that. But listening to Elvis singing Hound Dog, you know, I mean, I'd never seen a hound dog.
But the
music seemed as if it came from next door and it belonged to us as well. And I think that was the experience of young people all over the world. You know, so I think for all of us, it was music that seemed to belong to us, and our parents disapproved. You know, so it was kind of oppositional music and generational music. And I think it grew up with us. You know, so when I got to Britain, it was just about the time when a real revolution in the music was happening there because of the Beatles, and so
Academy
on. Yeah.
Street and all of that, yeah.
So it just felt like a part of that. And I lived on the King's Road in the Summer of Love, so that was fun.
I was told you used to do an imitation of Elvis. You used to get up and wiggle the old hips and do your thing.
Yes, the pelvis was in better shape in those days.
So you don't try it.
You don't want to see it now.
Well, when you came then, when you came to Carnaby Street in London and so on, everybody was pointed in your direction because the Beatles were leading the rush to play sitars, mm-hmm, and going to see the guru in India and listening to what his wisdom. Does that sound peculiar to you?
Well, it was completely peculiar because the India I'd come from was a great big city, you know, just fully the equal of London or New York or anywhere. And yet the India in people's minds was this very mystical place full of, you know, gurus and lentils and yoga and so on and so on. And I didn't know what that was, but it had one great advantage, which is that for like 10 minutes in the history of the world, it was very, very sexy to come from India.
Ah.
And I was 20 at the time.
Ah.
So you would just say India and girls would go weak at the knees.
So you didn't lose out at all.
It was completely unscrupulous.
Pretty good time. Yeah. Now getting back to the book, you work in rock and roll and you work in a tragedy and you work in love and romance and a lot of sex.
A lot of sex this time.
Yes. And just like your other books, Satanic Verses, of course, which I remember reading because you were on the show that time. It's a long, involved story.
But I like long yarns. And I think certainly when I'm enjoying a book, I don't like it to end, you know, and I like to live in that world. And this is, I mean, it's a book that begins in India at the time of the British Empire. It ends in New York at the time of the American Empire. And it tells a love story of lovers who move between those worlds, literally between those worlds, but also in a way, in the last half century, that's a move we all made, you know, between the period of British dominance and the period of American dominance. And so it's also about that. But most of all, I wanted to write a love story. You know, that was my going in position, was to find a way of writing a contemporary love story that didn't fall into either of the great traps these days of too much sentimentality or too much cynicism, you know, but to find a way of writing about passion, you know, head on.
Yes, and when did you first meet Bono?
It must be 7 or 8 years
seven
ago.
I went to, at his invitation,
a concert at Earl's Court in London during the, I suppose, Achtung Baby tour it was. And we got on, and then a couple of years after that, when the band were playing Wembley Stadium, they invited me to go on stage as a gesture of support for free speech and so on. So I had the odd experience of playing Wembley.
Yes, but you didn't fly in by helicopter at dead of night to land on the beach in Killarney instead.
No, that's all nonsense. That's all. Unfortunately, when newspapers try and make up stories, unfortunately, it's usually bad fiction. I mean, if I wanted to make up a story about me and Bono, I could make up a better one than that.
Yeah, but you were in Killarney. I've been there a few times,
but the idea of living there for 4.5 years is bizarre.
Go back to London and attending the guru and all of that and spirituality and these people looking for spirituality and looking for the secret of life and all of that. Are you a spiritual person, as they say? A spiritual person?
Well, you know, I think the word's been exactly that. The word's been overused, you know, and it's become rather a kind of debased word, and I think we should just give it a rest.
Yes.
I'm very interested in the human spirit and in what it's capable of and in what we are able to dream up for ourselves and our imaginative lives and so on. But I resist the word spiritual because it's become a kind of Californian empty word. So I think we leave it alone for 200 years or so. It might start meaning something again.
And what about poor Glenn Hoddle?
Well, you know, the thing about me and Glenn is that we go back a long way because I'm a Spurs fan. So I remember when Glenn used to give me a lot of pleasure in the great Spurs team where he played with Ozzy Ardiles and so on. And then, unfortunately, he turned into a dork. And it's because he stopped talking with his feet and he started talking with his mouth, you know, and what ended up is the foot ended up in the mouth.
Yes.
And I just thought, go back to your feet, Glenn, you know, stick with the feet.
What was your reaction to what he was trying to say at that time?
Well, it was just terribly jumbled what he was trying to say, poor man. You know, I don't believe he's a malicious man.
I just think he's
not very articulate. And he jumbled up a whole series of ideas, bits from Christianity, bits from Buddhism, bits from Hinduism. Kind of the way it came out sounded absolutely terrible. But I think that, you know, he basically lost his job because he didn't know how to speak very well. And that's probably not a good idea.
I read recently that you're going back to Bombay, but you're tentative about it, nervous about it.
Well, I haven't been back for a long time, and that's always odd, you know, to go back to your hometown, to the place where you were a child, after quite a long period of estrangement. I mean, I hope it'll be fun, you know. I mean, it's going to be interesting to try and regain that old sense of connection. It'll either come back or it won't, and I hope it does.
Now, Bono has taken the words of the ground beneath her feet and lyrics and put music to them and so on, all of that. Is that being released at the same time as the book, or is that...
No, the book's out.
The book's out, of course.
I think, all that happened is that I sent him a copy of the book, and there's a song in the book.
Yes.
A lyric in the book with the same title as the book, The Ground Beneath Her Feet. And so it's, I guess it's the title track, I suppose one would say, and now that I have to learn about the music biz. And he wrote a very beautiful melody to it, which I believe will be on their next album whenever that is.
Absolutely. And we have Bono later on in the show. Just one last thing. After all the avoidance and death and everything else, you had a bad crash in Australia, which almost broke you off.
Yes, I did. And that was a couple of years ago when I was there, and I'd gone was driving down after doing the book tour stuff to stay with friends for Christmas. And in this tiny village with the very literary name of Milton, we were hit by a very large truck. And I mean, actually, it was a truckload of fertilizer. And it mercifully didn't kill us, and it didn't shed its load. But I must say, I thought that after everything that had happened, to be destroyed by a truckload of fertilizer.
What a way to go.
What a way.
Terrible, terrible. Yeah. Well, thank you very much indeed for being on. You did your reading tonight. You're not doing a signing or anything tomorrow.
No, I'm not. I've done it today. But I did want to ask you something.
Yes,
now that you're going to have a bit of time.
Oh, yes, yes.
You know, are you going to write a novel? I think it's about time.
Think so, Salman. No. Wrote one book myself and wrote another book in cooperation with Deirdre Purcell. I think that's my bit.
Yeah.
I think I've done. So don't worry about any competition.
No, I was getting a bit nervous.
I might come up with something. You never know.
And many congratulations. It's wonderful to be here to tell you that.
Thank you. Well, many congratulations to you for still being here. Do you see in the next 2 years all of this thing being over?
Well, I hope so. I hope so. I just think that everybody's gradually calming down, and I think enough already, and
get on with your work.
Yeah,
well done.
Exactly.
Okay, long life and happiness to you, Salman. Thank you very much indeed. Salman Rushdie, ladies and gentlemen. Well done. Thank you. Thank you. Thanks very much. I'll see you later. Thank you. Now, I want to step down here to make room because... you know, ladies and gentlemen, that the last 20 years has seen a fantastic upsurge in the arts in Ireland, with the likes of Seamus Heaney's Nobel Prize, of course, and Brian Friel's plays absolutely sweeping the world. And we've had many, many successes for our musicians and writers, and we glory in that indeed. But even the biggest hits, ladies and gentlemen, can have a downside, and that is the sad story of my next guest. She will explain it herself. Would you come this way, please? Thank you, and explain your sad story.
You didn't see a fella in a black leather suit anywhere around here, did you? Thanks be to God, oh God. Ever since he first appeared, my life has not been worth living. I'll tell you all about it now. It's only 2 years ago, there I was, happy as a sandboy, working at the checkout in Dunn Stores in Letterkenny, when I spotted him in the queue. Oh, dear God, I should have recognized him, you know. Oh, dear God, girls, he was devilishly handsome. Golden hair shining with gel like a sunset in Bundoran. Dressed in leather from head to toe, zips everywhere, everywhere. For easy access, I'll say no more. Anyway, he comes up to me at the checkout and says he to me, "How would you like to be in showbiz, pet?" says he. "My name is Michael Flatfoot." And he said, "I saw you dancing a jig in the Butthole in Ballybough Vale last night, and I think you could make it big." Well, it was true. I did do a wee bit of Irish dancing, you know. Strictly traditional. Now, the white ankle socks and the ringlets, my mammy keeps them at home in the freezer. And, you know, the 40 medals bouncing on my chest. "Well," says he, "you may have heard of my show, The Lord of the River. Well, I am now mounting." That was the word he used, mounting. "I am now mounting a new extravaganza called Athlete's Feet. And I think you'd be a great addition to the combo. Oh, Lord Almighty, girls, it was what I always dreamed of, the big time. Dancing across the great stages of the world. Broadway, Los Angeles, Portadown. Before you could spell Lily Comerford, I was signing the contract in the back of his Porsche. Oh, gee, Mary and Jay. I should have read the small print. 15 one-night stands a week. 50 girls from all over Ireland, all handcuffed together on the stage, dancing up and down, over and across America. I went through 20 pairs of shoes and 15 leather miniskirts were in flitters. In flitters. I was in flitters myself. You'd never think to look at me and now I'm only 24. Well, 25. I begged them, we all begged them to let us go. But they said we'd signed a contract till 2009. 2009? Should I be fit for nothing but the scrap heap and adjudicating at fish kills? But love will find a way. There was this backing group on the show called Balloona. And one of the balloons, his name was Shorsha, and he was a singer. Well, he was more of a mimer, really, because it was all pre-recorded, you know. Well, it was love at first sight. And one night in Minnetonka, Minnesota, says he to me, "Buck this, Rosie, I'm going to bite my way through their handcuffs." And so he did. Ah, Lord, his smile was never the same again, but we were free. Well, now we were on the run in America. We disguised ourselves as a couple of Mexican cabaret artists singing the homes of Donegal under sombreros. Tus cojones son como las montañas en las casas de Donegal, ole. Oh, I'll tell you now, it went down a treat. And one day we were busking on the beach in Florida and we were surrounded by police. God, says they, yous are not real Mexicans. I don't know how they knew that. I mean, I'd grown a moustache and everything. Well, there was nothing to do but to run for it. Well, swim for it, really, because we were on the beach. And we jumped into the water, and as luck would have it, didn't I see a wee sign on the beach saying, "This way the Cayman Islands." Well, says I, "Sure, sure, that's the place for us, because I believe there's a big Irish connection there." So we set off, and we swam, and we swam, and we swam, and we swam. And just as we were coming into Cayman Port, didn't I spot a beautiful big yacht with an Irish flag on it? God says, "I, Shorsha, we'll get home on this one," and we jumped in through a porthole. And we had a real soft landing. And we looked around, and what was there? Hundreds and hundreds of brown paper bags with millions and millions of pounds in it. Oh, Lord. And we looked up through the porthole, and there we saw a whole lot of people we knew. I'll tell you, you know them too. All drinking champagne. What did you say to me? Name names. I'm willing we left it. Oh, now, them boys has no sense of humour and a lot of lawyers. Well, anyway, we kept alive eating the wee bits of the brown paper bags. And when we arrived back at Inishfickle, in Ireland, we were that thin, didn't we, get great jobs all summer working as extras on Angela's Ashtray. Well, oh God, it's great to be home. But I can never feel secure. Do you know the way? Sometimes I wake up with a start in the middle of the night, I think I heard the hum of the Porsche, and I'm going to be dragged again away on the river of no return. Girls, take my advice. Stay well clear of the tawdry, empty glamour of Irish dancing. Stick to the old discos and rock and roll, because you'll end up worse than Salman Rushdie. Night. Oh, there goes.
Well done.
You.
Rosalind Linehan. Rosalind Linehan. Now, where is Michael Snell? Let me see you. Where's Michael Snell? Well, there you are. Michael, good evening to you. Now, I want to... This man, Michael Snell, was on the first Late Late Show. Am I right, Michael?
That's correct.
As a member of the audience. The odd thing is that Rosalind Linehan was a panelist on the pilot for The Late Late Show. God be with the days we used to do pilots in RTE before we put stuff out in the air. But she was on the pilot for The Late Late Show. You were actually on the... How did that come about tonight?
Oh, well, it was a cheap date.
Yes, cheap date.
through an advertisement.
Oh,
on, yeah. Well, on TV when they were starting this new programme and looking for...
And if you would like to be a member of the audience.
Well,
and
looking
that,
for guests.
Yes, I see.
For an audience.
I see, yes.
So it was... Took a bus into Donnybrook.
Yes. On your own?
On my own, yes. Oh, I was 16 then.
16?
Yes.
And you didn't come with anybody, did you?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
Oh, you did?
Oh, I came
to
collect the tickets first after the advertisement and came with a young girl.
Yes.
On the that night.
Did you meet her that night?
I'd known her a few weeks.
I see. You were doing a line, yes.
Seeing
each other.
This sort of helped, bringing her to a television
Indeed.
Show.
Well, that was a sort of a good thing
well,
to
it
do.
It was, yes.
And you were, so do you remember what was on the show or what went on?
No, I don't really know. No.
Why not, Michael?
It's a long time ago, 37
yes,
years.
No, yes.
I don't remember anything about
it. But you were excited and delighted to be with her in the audience.
Well, I think that was probably, I was more interested in her, yes, than
yes. You were
the
concentrating
show
on her.
Yes.
Well, I wouldn't blame you, so you don't remember anything.
Not really, Gay.
Not even me.
Yes.
Vaguely.
Well,
right, okay, you were reminded down through the years. And what happened then? How long did you go out together, the two of you?
Oh, only until September. I went away to sea then. And the time I came back, she obviously thought it was too long away. She'd gone out with somebody else.
I see. What was her name?
Roberta Woodhouse.
Roberta Woodhouse.
Mm.
I see. And you've never... Where did she live?
She came from Dorky. She lived in Dorky, yeah.
And what did she... Well, she wasn't working at that stage, was she?
No, she was still at school,
I
think, I presume.
I see. And were you at school then?
No, I just left school.
You went off to sea. I see.
Yeah,
and you haven't seen each other since?
No.
I see.
No.
And you're married now to
yes,
to
my wife here, yes.
And do you know whether she's married or not?
I have no idea.
No
I haven't
idea.
Seen her for 36
she
years.
She only lives in Dorky. If I haven't said, why didn't you sort of ever find out and say hello or anything?
I haven't been to Dorky in 36 years, probably.
It's only down the road,
Michael. Get a bus from off his shoes away.
Oh, yes, we did. We went back there once a few years later and met her mother, yes.
I see.
Again.
Where's Roberta?
No.
Where's Roberta? Where are you, Roberta? Come down to me, Roberta. Come down to me, Roberta. Come down. Come out, Michael. Come out here. Dear, oh dear, oh dear, oh dear, oh dear. There you are. God, face the audience there, Michael. Turn around and face the audience. He barely remembers you, Roberta. Isn't that
terrible.
Desperate? Do you remember being at the first Late Late Show?
I do.
And had you only... do you remember anything that was on it?
No.
You only had eyes for him and he only had eyes for you and that was it.
I think so.
What a terrible disappointing pair you are. And are you, you're married now, Roberta?
Yes, I am.
And where are you living?
Stillorgan.
You didn't move far from
no,
Dorky, see?
No.
And have you children?
I have three boys.
Three boys. And have you children,
I
Michael?
I have indeed.
What
two.
Two. What?
A boy and a girl.
There you are. You remembered. I knew you would. So you haven't seen each other since?
No.
And is your husband here with you, Roberta? He is.
Yes.
And does he know about...
Oh, he does.
Oh, he does. And does your wife know?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
You admitted everything.
Oh,
you
yes.
See? I
yes.
See.
I admit all my old girlfriends.
Greet each other, and then we want to invite you to have a little dance together later on, and perhaps a little drink, just to remember old times. Go on, greet each other. Look what you missed out. Well done. Well, congratulations to the two of you for having been at the first Late Late Show. There's a thing to claim. All right.
It is. To be quite honest, it was all arranged by somebody else.
Who?
Which I'd have to thank. It was Kilkenny Local Radio.
Then?
No, now.
Now?
Of coming today.
Ah, I see. Yes, I beg you. You have me confused. We're all confused about it, Kilkenny Local Radio. Anyway, thank you very much indeed, both of you, for coming. You knew nothing about it. Roberta was in on the plot, you see, just
well,
to reunite.
That.
There you are.
Incredible, absolutely incredible.
All right, good luck to you. Thank you. Enjoy the rest of the show. Thank you, Roberta. Very good. Very good. Mike! Nothing like that happened to you on the live, Mike.
Nothing happened like
nothing
that on
like
the live,
that on
Mike.
The live, Mike. There
sure,
you are.
Yeah.
You're bringing me back now? Is that what you're saying?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. Well, that's true.
Your memories of Late Late Show. And
yeah, I remember the Late Late Show well. It was a little program that used to go out against the live mic. Listen, I want to wish you a happy retirement.
Yes.
I think you deserve it, and I hope you have a great time. But apart from that,
yes,
having said that,
yes,
when we were doing the live mic back in the 80s, and we used to have an annex directly opposite the Late Late, and the live mic crowd was a much brasher crowd of people. A lot of them are here tonight, surprisingly enough. A lot of people think the only time I ever got you unawares was the time in Trinity College.
That's
but
right.
It's not strictly true.
I remember it well.
It's very hard for me to tell the story looking at you, because you're just going to keep shaking your head and saying it didn't happen, okay? But I'm just going to tell the story anyway. We were in the live mic office on one day, and this guy from Limerick came in, and he had with him a box, a really ugly looking big box, about 4 feet square, with chicken wire on top of it. Half of it was hidden, so it was blocked off, but in the other half, you could see bits of apple butts and bits of chicken bones and things, and there was the tail of an animal, a furry tail of an animal, sticking out of the bit where you couldn't see it, okay? So he put it down on the ground, we all gathered around, and a man said, "What's in there is a mongoose." Now he says, it's asleep at the moment, but I'm going to try and wake it up. Now when I wake it up, it'll come out, it'll be spitting, it'll be screeching, it'll be doing, but it can't get out, so don't worry about it. But if it did get out, it'd go for your ankle, and they have such strong jaws that they'd powder the bone of your ankle if they got onto your ankle, you see? So we were saying, "God, is that right? Go on, wake it up. Wake it up." So your man got the stick, you see, and he started poking at the thing, at the tail, and the next minute, didn't the thing open up? The yoke flew out and landed on the knees of one of our team, who nearly passed on with the fright. But all it was a little bit of fur. like a kind of a Davy Crockett hat. So it was a joke. So somebody in my crowd said, "God, wouldn't it be a scream to try it out on Gay?" So I said, "Okay." So I said, "I'll bring it over with your man." Des McCarthy was your man's name, over to Gay's office. And the rest of them said, "We'll look in the window." So they went over to his office and looking in the window. So he was on his own sitting behind his desk. And I went in, "Hey, listen, Gay, we're kind of full up on Friday night. So there's a brilliant item here. I think you could use it on the Late Late Show. It'd be well worth looking. What is it? What is it?" So I said, "Look, you'll have to come out from behind the desk to look at this, you see." So, "Yes, yes, what is it?" So I said, "It's a mongoose. You see it there?" And I'm angling the box around so that I can get it at the right angle, you see. So he's out from behind the desk, standing there, the feet crossed, and I said, it's a vicious little bugger. If it gets out, you know, it'll go for your ankle, it'll bite into your ankle, break the bone, savage little thing it is. But it's okay because it's in there. Right, let's see what it does. Wake it up. So your man starts jabbing around at it, and the next minute, up it comes, out it flies, and lands on his ankles. Well, he let a roar out and went for the filing cabinet and started climbing up the filing cabinet.
I remember. It's great. I'm not talking to you anymore. Oh, I remember. That man is the bane of my life. He has scourged me all my life. Now, thank you, Mike, for that, and you're very welcome, and thank you for your good wishes. Now, we asked Frank, who has been our musical director for, Frank, 20 years musical director of the Late Late Show, and he wanted to do something special for us on our last program, and he's put together his own arrangement of what he considers is a suitable tune, and so do we. You'll all recognize him. Would you welcome, please, Frank McNamara and the Halcyon Strings.
Thank you.
Lovely, tasteful thing. Thank you very much indeed, Frank. Lovely arrangement and beautifully done.
Before you go,
he has a surprise for me. What? This? Dennis, did you know about this?
I noticed the last time I was in your house, you had no photographs. I went through an awful lot of trouble to make sure that this would get pride of place in the Byrne household. I had a photograph taken with Meryl Streep, especially for you. Now,
it's a fake.
It's real.
It's a fake.
It's real. There we were, taking a break.
Where did you meet Meryl Streep,
years ago,
my darling
Barstown
Meryl?
Camp.
In where?
Barstown. Barstown
Camp.
Camp.
Really? I hate you.
So that's
I hate
selling
you.
Out together.
I hate.
Now will you hang that up?
Yeah, I certainly will hang that up. I'll cut it in half and hang it up. Thank you, Frank. Speaking of photographs, that there's a CD and it has my photograph on the front of it. Do you see that? And it's a CD of To Whom It Concerns, you see, our theme song. It's an extended version. It was released nationwide today. You may have heard it already on the wireless, but it certainly has been played in the trendier nightclubs, and I'm told it's going down a grand little treat. Really and truly, a whole new audience. The good news is that all the proceeds from the sale of this CD goes to the GB Show Fund, which we are now trying to regularise in a real way and continue it to help people in need all over the place. And furthermore, there's one for everybody in the audience. So there. There. Watch out for it in the shop. All proceeds to the GB Show Fund. Let's take a break. Come back to us after this. Thank you. Go, go, go. Well done. Now,
I used to wear glasses till I started eating Pal. I know, I'm only joking. Thanks, Pal.
For a mortgage made to measure, choose Irish Permanent. Irish Permanent. We create the mortgage for you.
Here's more better value from Dunn's Stores. Check out our Californian wine sale with lots of new wines and savings across the range. We've breaded chicken fillets, family pack, only £4.99. Save £1. And tender-cut Irish roast loin of pork, only £1.99 a pound. Dunn's Stores better value beats them all every day.
Thanks, Pal.
Jules Lyotard was not a dreamer. But he had a dream to perform the first flying trapeze. So he dedicated himself to an original idea. We still do. Bulmer's Original Cider. All in its own good time.
Smoother, firmer feeling skin in just 3 weeks. New L'Oreal Revitalift now contains twice as much pro-retinol A. Revitalift reduces the appearance of wrinkles.
My skin is smoother.
Revitalift helps firm facial contours.
My skin feels firmer.
Revitalift, L'Oreal's best-selling anti-wrinkle cream worldwide. Now with a new formula.
L'Oreal, because I'm worth it.
New Nivea Sun Spray. It helps protect your skin.
Hello!
Okay, folks, that's all for now. You can roll it there, Ocean.
What do you think of that, Gay? Would you put the word in for me? Thanks, pal.
We were looking for a... Don't be afraid, you're all right. Don't be afraid. Will you do this? Will you do this? Okay, you do that. Okay, I'll stand down here. It's an easier shot. Betty O'Callaghan. That's Betty O'Callaghan there, and she's married to William. And we were looking for secure, solid, healthy, fit people who were born on the day the Late Late Show started. And we came up with Betty and William. Now, you were born in the Enfield Hospital in Cork, is that
correct?
Right?
Yes, Gail.
You were both born in the same hospital. Talk to me, Betty.
I was born on the 6th of July, 1962, and William was born the following day. And the same hospital, our mothers were in the same wards.
And did your mothers know each other apart from that?
Vaguely, yes. Vaguely, just to, you know, just to see maybe, yes.
Yeah. Well, you weren't watching the Late Late Show that night, were you?
No, I slept quite a bit. I was just newborn, you know, so.
So then you grew up close to each other, did you?
About a mile and a half. Yeah.
And when did you meet as fella and girl like?
When we were about 17. About 17 we met.
And was it lovely?
St. Francis Hall. A lot of people in Cork would know that.
For a
venue. Sorry?
For a hop, a little dance.
Yes,
I see. And was it love at first sight?
No, not really.
No?
Maybe for William.
They always say things like that, don't they? Was it love at first sight, William?
Definitely. I just saw the back of her head first. And it was blind, so I was partial to blind, so I went around to the other side of the hall to get a look at the face, and I was quite pleased with the face as well.
So it started there,
I'll ask her, I'll take her home.
And you did? So you were both aged, the same age, 17. Obviously.
17.
And how long did you court each other then?
8 years.
God, he's called Flash.
I tell you, he wasn't in any hurry.
were you in a hurry, Betty?
No, not really, no.
And you have various coincidences about July. You were born in the day of each other.
That's right.
You were both born in the same hospital. What else?
And,
on our 18th birthdays, we went out to celebrate her birthday, and we tried to hail a cab in Leitrim Street, so we eventually got one. And the cabbie said, look, I have to deliver a package first. He said, do you mind if I drop the package off and then I'll drop you home? So he said, no bother. So we jumped into the back of the cab. We were oblivious to where we were going, young 18-year-olds. So he said, look, after about 10 minutes, he's pulled up and he said, I'll only be a couple of minutes. He says, I've got to drop a package here. So we kind of looked around to see where we were. We were actually back at the scene of the crime, Erinville Hospital, 18 years later to the day.
Yes. Sitting in the car park.
And did you have any children born in July?
Yes, our first son was born in July.
I see.
And our anniversary is July as well. So we celebrate for the whole month of July.
And when did you start watching the Late Late Show?
Oh,
not
really.
July.
So far when we were allowed to stay up.
Well, it's lovely to have you with us on the final one.
Thank
well
you.
Done. Give them a round of applause. Thank you. Mamie, where's Mamie? There you are, Mamie. Good evening. Now, Mamie O'Sullivan won tickets for tonight's show on Marion Finucane's programme.
That's right.
For telling her favourite story about the Late Late Show. And in case you didn't hear it on Marion's programme, you better tell it to us again, because
right,
it's mildly disgraceful about Gay. Well, of course, no wonder you won the tickets. That'll suit everybody.
Well, Gay, I'm delighted to be here with you.
Thank you.
It took me 37 years to get it.
Yes.
Well, now my mother adored you, my late mother. And every Saturday night, because it was Saturday at that time,
yes,
we had you to ourselves, and nobody could knock at the door or make any sound. She thought it would be outrageous if anybody interrupted Gay. In fact, all the years that she watched you, if she ever had a complaint, she used to complain. She'd say, I'll get on to Gay Byrne about you. She thought you could fix everything. She never needed a solicitor.
Yeah.
She said, I'll get on to Gay about that. Anyway, she hadn't been well, and she came to live with me and the family. But she used to always pray that she would go, when her time came, that she would go in her sleep, because she dreaded hospitals, and she said she didn't want anybody hologoning and praying around her. She wanted to go fast
right
when the time was up. So this particular evening, it was 1981, Christmas, and we were watching you, and we were having our little drinkies and loving it. And the next, somebody phoned in and offered you money to take off your trousers. You sidetracked it for a while, but the money started getting bigger, and you couldn't ignore it.
I remember this was in connection with a trouser press or something, was it? I
think. Don't ask me, but I haven't a clue. Anyway.
Don't tell me.
Towards the end, the audience got onto it, and they kept saying, "Go on, go on," and you said, "Oh, all right." And you took off your trousers, and my mother got hysterical laughing. She couldn't be consoled. Well, she said you were always so dignified, she never thought she'd see you like that.
Don't try it again, anybody, before you get the bright idea. It's not going to work. Go on, Mamie, yes.
So I put her to bed. She was still laughing.
Still laughing?
Tucked her in. Yes. She couldn't be consoled. She said, God, Gay, I never thought you'd do it. And tucked her in. Out the light, went down the hallway, still listening to her laughing, and that was the last time my mother was alive. When I went the next morning, she had died in her sleep.
Good heavens.
But I want to thank you for giving her a lovely last night on earth.
I'm not quite sure how to take that, Mamie, but however... Yes, if you want to be dispatched quickly, contact Gable. That's it. I thought for a moment you were going to blame me for the poor woman's death.
No, not in the least.
She went away happy.
Well, she got her wish.
She did.
She did. She got her wish.
Very good. That's a lovely story, Mamie. Thank you for it. Well done. All right. Marion, follow that.
It is a lovely story.
Yes.
I didn't realize you were quite such an exhibitionist, Gabe. I must have missed that.
It only happened once. Some other fella, I think, on the program was supposed to do it, and he backed out. Chickened out at the last moment, and then somebody had to do it. So, as usual, Gabe ought to.
I hoped you had ironed your boxers. I hope you had before you came on, if you weren't expecting to do it. Anyway, I would like to also wish you a great retirement.
Yes.
My memories of the Late Late Show, oddly enough, are the early ones. Your man was saying over there when we were allowed up. I was allowed up if I didn't say too much. And my mother used to, at the beginning of it, we didn't have a telly, and she used to go down to her friend, Rita Hourihan, and I wasn't allowed at home on my own, so she told me down with her, presumably thinking that it would all wash over me. But I found it exotic and exciting, I have to say. Marion. The whole experience.
Thank you.
I was saying it on the program myself. I saw my first living, breathing, real communist. You know, like there in the room. No horns, no tail. There he was. I saw Brian Tremascus. This was in our own sitting room. We had a telly at this stage. And my mother was saying, "That young pup." And I was delighted with what he was saying. And so on. And Fergal O'Connor talking about divorce. And they were raising, I was reared in a way that was the way life was, that was the way it would be, and that's the way it would continue, secular, secularum, because that was the right way for it to be. And this subversive thing in the corner was suggesting that there might be another way. And I found it wonderful, and I found it exhilarating. And it was those shows that actually stand out for me, and I was very young at the time. Mm.
Isn't it amazing? Nobody ever forgets his name, Brian Tremascus, and it's the most unusual.
I can see him.
Yes.
I can actually see him. And criticising a bishop.
He called him a moron. He called him a moron.
I mean, it was just beyond imagination.
Not only that, but he criticised the bishop the week before, and said his cathedral was a monstrosity and a waste of money and so on.
Right.
And he came back the following week to apologise and called him a moron.
We're sitting there saying,
Brian, not what we had in mind, son.
But it's interesting. You wouldn't do that now in a peculiar way because things have changed so much that you wouldn't really, you know. But I found all that very exciting, and I found it very... as I say, subversive, I think, is the nicest word I can give to it. So thanks a lot.
Thanks for that, Marion. Thank you very much. Marion for me. Well done. And believe it or believe it not, not many people know this, but Charlie Bird was also a researcher on The Late Late Show, and having trained so well in that position, he went on to finer and greater things. Good evening to you, Charlie.
Good evening, Gabriel. How are you?
Yes. And what memory do you have to recall?
Well, I have a couple of memories, but the first one is every Friday in the RTE canteen, egg and chips.
Egg and chips.
For those who haven't been in the RT canteen. Religiously, Gay Byrne comes in with Maureen, Maura Connolly, egg and chips for Gay every Friday. But I was a researcher for 3 months, and oh, what it was hell. It was awful. But afterwards, I went on to become a reporter in the newsroom, and I can remember one amazing occasion. We were actually sitting in the canteen one day discussing what would happen if Gay Byrne decided to leave RTE. How would the newsroom deal with this story? Would it be in the headlines? Would it be number two? Would it be number three? Lo and behold, about 2 or 3 weeks later, I'm not certain if it was Century or if it was TV3, but something happened in the National Concert Hall.
America,
was it? I know Joe Little, the reporter, came back and he said, listen, these people are putting out a big story. Some big person from RTE is about to leave. I was dispatched over to the, it was a building at the back of RTE to...
It wasn't a building, Charlie, it was a hut.
A hut, yes, well, Gay, I mean, let's... I went in, as I was going in, Eugene Murray, who was the editor of Today Tonight, was walking out, and he says, Charlie, he's saying nothing. I said, how do you mean he's saying nothing? He said, he won't say a word. So I walked in, and I looked at you, and I said, hiya, Gay. And Maura was sitting opposite you, and I said, listen, look, I've got to ask you the question. And he said, I'm not saying anything. I said, look, Gay, I have a job to do. I really want to get the story. And he says, have you a biro? I said, yeah, I have a biro. Have you a piece of paper? I said, yes. He says, okay. He says, I've had an offer. I'm making up my mind. It'll be before the weekend. And now fuck off.
I did not. Mary O'Sullivan. Mary O'Sullivan is sitting there and she's mouthing, I don't believe it.
Not only that, I went back to the RT newsroom.
Gay never used language Thank you, Mary, darling. I'll talk to you later.
To the RT newsroom and I told them, and I said, listen, this man has, he's teased something. I had to, my boss told me to ring somebody in personnel or in RT. I rang, I got a phone call off the record from the Director General of RT. I'd never spoken to people like that before in my life. And he says, this is off the record. He says, not for quotation on the 9 o'clock news. He said, but we've been in negotiations with Gay Byrne. He's renewing his contract. And anyway, he put out the story. I think it was number two in the bulletin that night. So you didn't make it to number one. You made it to number two. The next morning, it was on every paper in the land. And by about 4:30 or 5 o'clock that evening, RTE issued a statement to say that Mr. Gay Byrne had renewed his contract with RTE. Gay, I don't know how much you got from them, but you bloody well did it well.
Well done. Thank you, Charlie. Thank you indeed. Now, thank you very much for being here, Charlie. I still deny all knowledge of what went on. Now, on the show down through the years, as you know, we spoke about many, many things, ladies and gentlemen. All sorts of things, great arguments about this, that, and the other, politics and communism, Marion remembered, all of that class. But we also, on occasion, spoke about sex. These are some of the clips about sex through the years. Have a look.
Never before has your show stooped so low to discuss so little. Oh boy, what a show it turned out to be. Not a holy show, but a dirty, disgraceful, rude, garbage heap of codswallop.
Of course, we recognize that people have misgivings about homosexuality because it's something that they don't come across every day.
How can you say it's normal? That's normal for me.
It's not normal for a man to be preoccupied with another man's back passage.
What about men who are besotted with women's front passages?
There's a cross to be carried in the Christian life, which may mean that I have to restrain my sexual appetite, or it may mean I have to put up with certain things I don't like.
Well, Gerard, I'd like to know if you believe in sex before marriage.
Always.
All higher primates masturbate. All human beings masturbate.
The word we call it was the rude word, wanking.
All human beings do not masturbate. That is incorrect.
We had one very good games master who had a more subtle approach. He told us that it was sap or stamina at the hurling. Now, hurling was very important in those days.
The most stupid question I was ever asked in my life was at 17 years of age, do you have bad thoughts?
We had nothing else but bad thoughts.
How to deal with impure thoughts? Take exercise, fresh air, a healthy Christian attitude, or think of the courage of ambushing a column of black and tan.
In the ordinary course of life, one is surrounded by the various
you know, various animals, and we're surrounded by the ordinary family life. These things don't need to be taught, no more than you need to. You don't need to be taught how to drink a cup of tea.
Tonight out there, there are lots of our young people fornicating who aren't married, right? Would you prefer...
So your answer is, well, give them contraceptives.
I would not encourage my children to use condoms.
How old are your children?
One's 27, one's down at the Trinity Ball, but you have to be... He's down at the Trinity Ball.
27?
There it is, that's what it looks like, out of the thing.
People falling in a swoon all over Ireland at this moment, looking at that. Okay, if you'll pardon the expression, Roisin, would you roll it there, please? The condom is made of rubber, whether you knew it or not. There are two main types. On the left, a condom with a teat. On the right, plain without a teat.
I'm surprised and pretty shocked, to tell you the
You're
truth.
Surprised and pretty shocked? Yeah. Disappointed.
I'm a wee bit.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Ma'am.
You may save their lives with the piece of rubber,
yes,
but you will not save their souls.
Sexuality education is about letting young people talk about their own feelings about sex, allowing them to develop their own ideas, allowing them to talk about responsibility, the responsibility not to spread disease, not to cause unwanted pregnancy, the responsibility to enjoy herself.
A young girl, for instance, now of 17, 18, all she really has to do to have an income for 21 years or so is to have a baby outside of wedlock, and she's assured of, what, £34 a week for herself and the child. That's a terribly startling thing.
For an unmarried mother, it's hardly
well,
a living, though.
I don't call them unmarried mothers. Let's call them what they are, mistresses.
The greater hard-necked, ring-tailed, Atlantical warbler, known as the Kerryman, who is to be found singly and in flocks, late and early, high and low, where there is the remotest prospect of sex, wolves, football, fornication, and commotion.
The important thing is, I love Brendan, and whether our sexual relationship reaches the heights that is biologically possible for it is not important. The
well,
important
is
thing is,
no,
I don't think
right.
so.
She's
I don't
right,
think so.
Your heart is above your waist, so let's keep the mind and hands above it, too.
But every married couple in the country who go to bed are succumbing to lust?
Yes.
Every married couple?
Yes.
In Ireland and England and everywhere?
Yes.
That is all lust.
Well, the emotions are there, the feelings are there, because they like each other. But if you really love a person, if you really love them...
You help him in self-realization,
no,
not
let,
in
let,
dog's
let,
life.
Let mother... Do you mean there was an Irish MP yeah. involved? Do you mean an Irish MP now or an Irish
TV? I had a lot of Irish people come.
Really?
They were great fun. They're good spenders, too.
Oh, they're great guys.
They'd buy about three or four luncheon vouchers.
Yes, but...
I think it gets better as you grow older together. I think in marriage... If the sex is wrong in marriage, the sex in your marriage is wrong, that overflows into the other departments in your marriage. But
yes.
if the other departments are right, I think that's right. It's a bit like the hinge of the door. If the hinge is strong, the door swings well.
I want to ask
Brush.
How's his hinges?
How are your hinges, Brush?
I'm going to open a can of tea in one aisle right away, Gabriel.
Let's all hope that they've been using a condom.
When they do it, bonk, ba-bonk, bonk, 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 ba-bonk, bonk.
Yes, Dennis. Now, well done. We did all that. We lived through all that. We survived all of that. Great fun. Now, look at this, ladies and gentlemen. Look at your monitors. This is a very, very special limited edition sweater with the Late Late Show logo and carrying the legend 62-99. It's provided by our friends at Kilkenny. They've recently opened a brand new store in Leopardstown Racecourse, which is open every day, and they stock there all the things that you can buy in their store in Nassau Street. But to celebrate that, for everybody in the audience, we have a special sweater for you tonight from Kilkenny. That sweater, and we wish you well with it. We wish you well with it. You are lucky people to be here tonight to get this bag of goodies, I can assure you. Now, as I move towards retirement, I'm absolutely delighted to welcome on stage tonight an old friend of the Late Late Show for many years who is moving out of retirement and back into the limelight, I hope. Let's have a welcome, please, for Christy Moore. Christy, you're welcome.
brilliant to be here. Thank you very much. Of all the stars that ever shone, not one does twinkle like your pale blue eyes. And like golden corn at harvest time, your hair sailing in my boat, the wind gently blows and fills my sail. Your sweet scented breath is everywhere, and daylight peeping through the curtains of the passing night time is your smile. And the sun in the sky is like your laugh. Come back to me, my Nancy. Linger for just a little while. Since you left these shores, I've known no peace nor joy. No matter where I wander, I'm still haunted by your name. The portrait of your beauty stays the same. Standing by the ocean, wondering where you've gone, if you'll return again. Oh, where is the ring I gave to Nancy Spain? And on a day in spring, when snows start to melt and streams to flow, with the birds I'll sing a song. In while I'll wander down by Bluebell Grove, where small birds blow, and I'll hope that lovely Nancy will return. Sing. No matter where I wander, I'm still haunted by your name. The portrait of your beauty stays the same. Standing by the ocean, wondering where you've gone, if you'll return again. Oh, where is the ring I gave to Nancy Spain? Oh, where is the ring I gave to Nancy Spain?
Good to have you.
Welcome back. Welcome back. You, is that the one you sang to Eamon's daughters, Eamon Andrews' daughters?
That's right, here one night.
That's right, yeah, just sitting, yeah.
We sat over there and...
That's right, a very touching moment. Is it 27 years since you first appeared on the show?
It is indeed, with Planxty in 1972.
Yeah.
And it was all hair and flares and platforms and... I remember it really well. I was really full of myself, and I met you in the hall on the way in, and you put me down to size rapidly.
Oh, I didn't.
You did so perfectly. It was beautiful. You said, what are you doing here, Sonny? And then
I wouldn't be surprised.
I suddenly realized who was running the show.
And your mother, Lord rest her, was a great hit on the show, do you remember?
I certainly do. It was a great thrill to see Mammy on the show. And the amazing thing about that is everywhere I go, now people speak to me about my mother as a result of having seen her on the Late Late Show twice, I think. Mm. And she loved that experience. And we were all very proud of her, and thank you for the way you treated her.
Well, you should have been, but she was a lovely, lovely, everybody's idea of an Irish mammy, there's no doubt about it. Looked after you all very well. Now, didn't you make the headlines one time when you appeared on the show? You did something bold and
yeah, there was a show, I think about 1978. It was an anti-nuclear show.
We're talking about Cairnsore.
That's right. Oh, yeah. It was before Cairnsore Point.
Yes. They were going to build a nuclear plant in Cairnsore, yes.
And we got an anti-nuclear group together, and there were a lot of musicians involved, and you had us on the show here one night, and I sang a particular song, and the Taoiseach of the day, his wife did not approve of it.
Maureen Lynch.
Yeah.
And what happened?
Well, basically she rang in and she objected to my verse, and on Monday morning on the Irish Independent it said Taoiseach's wife slams ballad singer. And I never looked back since.
Well, that's not... I have to tell you, funnily enough, that I got a lovely little card from her on behalf of herself and Jack just yesterday. A lovely little card, and I was very grateful to get it. And she sent best regards and so on. She probably doesn't remember ringing up about you. Well, how are you?
Brilliant, thanks. Never felt better.
And do you recommend a few months off the treadmill yourself, if you do?
18 months is just about the ticket.
Yeah. You reckon?
Yeah. Time to do a bit of serious thinking, and it's been great for me anyway. I've had the first 3 or 4 months of it were not so great, but once I got myself together a bit and started to, find the track again, I've had a good time at home, and I've had, it was a coincidence that the year I took off was the year that Kildare got at the All-Ireland final, and I was at every game, and that was brilliant. But that said, it's been a good time, and I'm ready for to sing a bit again, but I probably won't tour anymore, but I would like to keep singing, but maybe a bit more laid back.
And what was it, Christy? Did you just run yourself into the ground? You did.
I think so. A good friend of ours, Patrick Nugent, pointed out to me that maybe I had gone too deep down into the well. And he led me by the hand for a couple of months because I needed leading. I think my wife and Patrick Nugent got me back on the track again. And looking back over the previous 2 or 3 years, I had been saying yes to everything. And travelling too much, and I forgot how to say no, basically.
That's right.
And probably got a bit greedy. Mm-hmm. You know? Mm-hmm. But hopefully things are different now.
You're doing a new album.
Yeah, I've had a great time. I recorded an album down in the garden shed, and it was great fun, no pressure, nobody knew I was doing it. A friend of my son's, a 23-year-old guy, I heard his music and he heard mine. And we spent 6 months down in the garden making an album. And I don't know what anybody's going to think of it, but I had a great time making it.
And whose songs are they? Are they all new stuff? Or?
There are only 3 new songs on it. I've written 3 new songs for it, and all the rest are a mixture of ancient songs and some songs that I've previously recorded.
But you're not going to tour again, you don't think?
I don't think so.
Big tours.
No.
Big tours.
No.
And what's your ideal now? Sort of smallish audiences, is that it, in places?
Well, I did my first gig last Monday night in 18 months. I played to 153 people down in Listowel Varna, and it was perfect.
Really?
It was really lovely. I had a lovely time. And I just sat down, and I was a lot more reflective. Instead of going out and trying to kind of beat people over the head with volume and just... Take it nice and easy.
Great. I'm delighted to see you again, sir. Yeah. And welcome back, and I'm glad you're well. Will you do another little number for
me? I'd love to, and wish you all the very best.
Thank you. You too. And you too. What's this one now? This is an old favourite.
I think either the first or second time I ever came to the Late Late Show, I sang a song with Planksty that I learned from a travelling man up in Boyle County, Roscommon, called John Riley. And he had a beautiful store of old gypsy songs. And this one is the Raggle Taggle Gypsy.
Raggle Taggle Gypsy. Well done. Thank you. Christy Moore, ladies.
Thanks, Gary. Thanks, everybody.
And there were 3 old gypsies came to our hall door. They came brave and boldly, oh. One sang high and the other sang low. And the lady sang the Raggle Taggle Gypsy, oh.
It was upstairs, downstairs the lady went, but on her suit of leather, oh, and it was the cry all around her door, she's away with the raggle-taggle gypsy, oh. Oh, she gave to them a glass of wine, and she gave to them some brandy, and the fine gold ring that the lady wore, oh, she gave it to the raggle-taggle gypsy. Well, it was late that night, so the Lord came in, inquiring for his lady, and the servant girl's reply to him was, she's away with the raggle-taggle gypsy, oh. Oh, then saddle for me milk-white steed, me big horse is not speedy, oh. I will ride and I'll seek me bride, she's away with the raggle-taggle gypsy, oh. Oh, then he rode east and he rode west, he rode north and south also, but when he came to the wide open field, there that he spied his lady, oh. Oh, then why do you leave your house and your land? Why do you leave your money, oh? You're a, why do you leave your only wedded lord, oh, for the raggle-taggle gypsy, oh? Yerra, what do I care for me house or me land? What do I care for money, oh? Yerra, what do I care for me only with the Lord? I'm away with me raggle-taggle gypsy, oh. It was there last night you'd a goose feather bed with blankets thrown so comely. Tonight you're going to lie in a white open field in the arms of your raggle-taggle gypsy, oh. Yerra, what do I care for a goose feather bed? What do I care for blankets? Tonight I lie in a white open field in the arms of me raggle-taggle gypsy, oh. Oh, for you rode east when I rode west, you rode high when I rode low, I'd rather have a kiss at the yellow gypsy's lips than all at the Lord's gold and silver, oh.
Thank you, Christy. Thank you. Well done. Thank you, Christy. Well done. And welcome back again. Where are Bronwyn and Connor O'Donnell, please? Hello, Bronwyn. You're welcome. How do you do? Tell us your fascinating story. This is a good story now. This is a good story.
Hi, how are you?
I'm very well. Good day, sir.
Good day.
God save you. Tell us your story about the Late Late Show and you.
Well, about 4.5 years ago, I was watching the Late Late one Saturday, and I was overdue with our second child, Kira. And on the Monday, my mother said to me, are you going to enter the Late Late quiz? So I said, I don't think I'll bother. And she said, go on, put one in. So I did. And she posted the letter, and off I went. So on the Thursday night, I said to Connor, I think we better go to the hospital. This baby's on the way. So we went in on Thursday night. We were there all Thursday. And eventually the baby was born on Friday. Kira was born at about 11 o'clock. So we were all very excited. And there wasn't a lot of sleep that day. And about 9:30 that night, Connor's mum said, do you want to go out for a pint with the lads? And Connor said, no, I'm too tired. I'm going to go home. And before he went out to the hospital, I said to him, I think Gay Byrne might ring you tonight.
That's true.
So I thought no more about it. And of course, I was looking at the show later on. And I saw you make a phone call. And I heard you say, can I speak to Conor O'Donnell? And I nearly passed peacefully out.
And I was asleep. Where was the baby at this stage?
Beside me.
Yes. And you were asleep?
I was asleep, I'm past afraid, asleep. Yes, not yes. Watching.
So at that stage, I think a few of the nurses had worked out from the conversation he had with Connor, and they came in to me and they said, is that your husband on the television? And I said, yes, it is. And he said, they said, is he clever? And I said, well, if it's current affairs or politics or sport, yeah, we're away in a hack. But I said, if it's soaps now or pop music, we could be in trouble. So next minute you asked him the question of what was the name of the pub in Coronation Street.
Oh.
And all the nurses saying, oh, that's easy. And I was going, no, he's
not
going to know it.
Not for him.
Because I knew I didn't know it. So somehow or other, he dug it up. And I asked him afterwards, I said, how could you have known that? He said, it was a Trivial Pursuit question.
Well, when I hesitated, the neighbors started shouting in the letterbox as well. They were running in at that stage.
The Rover's returned! And he won, you won what?
It was £10,000 of holiday vouchers.
Of what?
Of holiday vouchers.
Of holiday vouchers. Well done. And did you use them?
Oh, we did, yeah. Did? We had a great time. We were skiing in Italy, and we went to France, and went to Eurovision a couple of times with the children, and we've gone across to London to see a number of soccer matches. So
fantastic.
We had a ball.
So you've used it all up now?
All up, and thank you very much for your
support. Well, this is a lovely story. You're very welcome. Thank you. Very welcome. Well done, Connor. Congratulations on knowing the... Oh, no, the smart man. Smart man. I want to say hello very specially to an old, old friend, Coleman Hutchinson here. Okay. Hello, Sharon. How are you? And Coleman Hutchinson, let me tell you, was a researcher on The Late Late Show too, and he has now gone on like them all. He's gone on to greater things. He's the boss of Celador Productions, and he's just returned from Cannes, where he won a magnificent prize for the most successful television program to hit the UK in probably the last 15 years. Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? Congratulations to you, Coleman. Well done. Producer. Now, were you involved with Oliver Reed? Lord rest the poor saint.
I was. Yes. I remember that day very clearly.
How long were you with The Late Show at this stage?
Not that long. I was fairly new to the game.
Getting run in.
So Oliver Reed was a guest that night, and we'd met him earlier in the week, and he was absolutely lovely and fine, and it was all great and no problem. And he was due to come to the studios at 8:30 on the Saturday night, as it was then. So he arrived in, and he was absolutely fine again. But his first question was, where's the drink? And I said, well, fortunately, there's no drink at the moment. There's drink after the show. And he said, well, when is that? And I said, well, about 11:30. He said, but it's 8:30 now. I mean, you can't expect me to go from 8:30 to 11:30 and not a drink. Yeah. And I said, well, that's sort of the way we do it here, you know.
The rule.
There is no drink. That's the rule. He said, well, I'm going then. That's it. I'm off. So he said, take me to a pub. I have to go to a pub. And I said, well, it's not really the usual thing. He said, will you either take me to a pub or I'm going? So we had a little confab around and thought, what will we do? So decided the safest place would be the Montrose Hotel. So took him in the car. I drove him down to the Montrose Hotel with a friend who was with him, a lady friend who was with him. And it was all very quiet in the Montrose Hotel. And I said, right, look after him and I'll be back at 10 o'clock. Because we knew he was on about 10:45. So 10 o'clock came and I went back. All hell was breaking loose in the bar at the Montrose Hotel. Because he was standing on a chair. All of the bar was around him. He was doing handstands. He was doing everything. He was telling stories. People were 10 deep watching him. And I said to the friend who was with him, I said, it's time to go. And she said, I don't know what we're going to do, but this is the show. I mean, he's doing a show here and now. And there's no way I can see how we're going to get him out of here. So anyway, after much cajoling and with great help from this friend, I finally managed to persuade him to get into the car. And we were driving down the dual carriageway from the Montrose Hotel, and I was never as terrified in my life, because he started opening the door. He opened the door of the car and was jumping up and down, and saying, I think I'll get out here, I don't want to do this, I'm not sure what... I was terrified. So we arrived back at the studios, the time was just coming for you to introduce him. You introduced him, and I don't know whether you remember, but he ran on.
Yes.
Straight on, and he ran straight up again. He did one circuit of the thing and went straight out. And you were standing there thinking, what now, obviously? And you started to wrap up the show. And we didn't know whether you were really going to wrap up the show or whatever. But it sounded like, well, that was Oliver Reed and he's gone. And then he finally came back.
And he did. That was Oliver Reed.
Yeah. And so he did come back and he did an interview of a fashion.
Yes.
And also floored Susan George on that night as well.
Yes. He also did one other thing, and that is he was very, very drunk and he took a kitchen chair.
Yes, right, and
he did
balanced a
full-length handstand on the kitchen chair, feet right up in the air. And I was sitting at the desk up there and I was saying, he's now going to fall, he will break his back, he will break his neck, and RTE will be sued for £9 trillion. The mast is gone, the radio station, everything else. And then did he not tackle lovely Susan George?
He did.
And got her down on the ground.
Yeah, well, he sort of made a lunge, didn't he? And the chairs weren't fixed to the ground.
That's right,
the two of them ended up on top of one another.
And he ended up on top of Susan George.
He did.
And it became apparent that he was enjoying
not getting up,
being on Susan George. A And then it became obvious that he was enjoying a lot being on the George. And I remember this surreal moment when we were standing around him saying, up there, standing around him saying, ah, come on, Oliver, would you get up off Susan George and get your seat? Wonderful, wonderful memory. There you are. Well, so that was your, that's your outstanding memory of the Late Late Show. Yeah. And haven't you gone on to do great things? And congratulations to you, Colin. We're delighted.
Congratulations to you.
Well, now you are one of the finest and loveliest colleagues we ever had in the place. And it was a joy to work with you.
It was great fun to do.
There you are. There you are. You learn. That's Coleman Hutchinson. Dez, where are you, Dez? There you are, Dez. Now, Dez, you're not remembering particularly the Late Show. You're remembering the radio program, Dez, isn't that right?
Well, as a child, like the others who tried to stay up, I had a conflict on Saturday nights because Match of the Day was on as well, you know. And
terrible crisis.
Well, I remember, actually, I didn't think of it until Marion and the man from Cork here were talking about earlier. I remember, actually, the first Late Night I saw, only because I remember when I was allowed to stay up for Match of the Day, my father was out, so we watched the first hour of the Late Late. Then Match of the Day. It was QPR in Leicester City, 1969, Loftus Road. I don't know why. Joe Waters played in it. Jimmy McGee would remember it.
He doesn't.
But anyway, that's the first night I was allowed to stay up in 1969. Yeah. But I obviously never thought I'd be working in the vicinity of you or whatever. But today, I went through, when I was used to fill in the radio in the summer.
Yes.
And went through a couple of the things that we did. Like, I mean, how does a fellow come in? It was hard enough to go in and, you know, replace you when you're away without being a sports guy and people saying, what's he on about now? And tell him to shut up about sport and all this. But I went through a couple of things. We started a thing called the Joke Box, which was great fun and showed that the people of Ireland, if somebody, this was just a phone number and you'd phone and leave a joke and somebody would phone in and if one person told a joke about Paddy the Irishman, you'd suddenly get 60 calls about, you know, the next, or one about a pig or one about, and you got all these jokes. But I went through the list. But one thing that started was, that is now flying around the internet on email. There's one, Larry Gogan, there was one about quiz answers. They just became phone calls. People started phoning in with silly quiz questions and answers that were given. And this is flying around now, like, what's the capital of France? F, you know, and name a bird with a long neck, you know, Naomi Campbell. All these ones started. And there's one going that I never asked Larry about, where Larry allegedly asked someone. These people remember these, so yes. Whether or not they happened is another thing. But Larry was asked, finished saying as happy as, and
he says no, it never happened.
It spoils a great story. Yeah. And as happy as, and they were struggling. Larry said, think of me, and your man says, pig and shit. but this snowballed, and we got all these. And there was another email, Larry, about without going too far down the line, but there was one about. Name a place in Kildare that's named after a part of your body. Is that true, no?
What one is that, Des?
The thigh was the... Yeah.
And
we call it the cock.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it just kind of snowballed, you know.
Yes.
But I went through it and got a list that this thing is also going around, this... The worst ever country song titles.
Yes.
And you know, it started off one or two and three and four, and then everybody started ringing. And we did, now, whatever about those being made up, we did insist that you sourced them and that there was legitimacy. Mm. And we were going, Mama, get the hammer, there's a fly on Papa's head. There was a whole series of them, you know, if you're going to leave me, walk out backwards so I'll think you're walking in. There's a whole series of all these. And I just, the fun I got out of with your gang of listeners was the one thing I enjoyed before running back as quickly as I could to sport. But I enjoyed it all very much, and well done on all your stuff.
Well done, Dez. Thank you. Well done. Okay, now. Now, ladies and gentlemen, our next guest, we've had him many times on the show down through the years, and we have totally and completely enjoyed him. We've laughed with him, we've cried with him, and he's always worth a good turn. Would you welcome, please, our old friend, Neil Tobin. Neil, you're welcome. Neil Tobin.
Good evening. My name is Immaterial. I'm an ordinary Dublin individual and consequently wish to remain anonymous, as we are an endangered species. I have the honour to deliver the inaugural Gay Byrne Millennium Lecture. From now on, this lecture will be delivered every 1,000 years by an ordinary Dublin individual subject to availability. Gay Byrne is a Democrat. He is passionately believes in free speech. He passionately believes in free everything. And after damn near 40 years of getting everything for nothing, his greatest achievement came when the Dublin Corporation thrown in the towel and said, "Ah, here, have the fucking city." The theme of my lecture is Great Poems of the Millennium. Now, I don't have time to recite them all, but I have chosen two. Number one, The Dancer by Anonymous. Michael Flatley, Lord of the Dance, is the feast for feminine eyes. But from constantly busting the front of his pants, he is also the Lord of the Flies. Poem number two, The Sportsman, also by Anonymous. Rumours of nasal sex have Anfield on its toes. Why else would Robbie Fowler wear a condom on his nose? Now, thank you for your attention. That was the lecture. Now, obviously, people don't follow Liverpool very closely, but anyway, they would have understood that better if they had. We have an election coming up. We have two elections coming up, which means that we are in for an unprecedented outbreak of orthodontal mendacity with concomitant rectal verbosity, which means lying through your teeth while talking through your arse. But before we leave the politics, I want to say something about the people who are involved in the peace process and so on, and how we wish them all well, and we are very, very impressed by what they do, and we're very moved by it. But I sometimes wonder if people, especially from the other side of the water, understand how deep are the divisions that go through Irish society, not just human society, but indeed animal society, the beasts of the field, the very fowl of the farmyard. Because did you know that there are such things as Republican hens and orange hens? Oh yes, there are. You go into a farmyard and you'll see a caucus of Republican hens there in the corner colloguing, saying, "Chuck, chuck, 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 chucky, chucky, alarm, chucky, alarm," while the orange hens go, "Fuck off!" So, I have been asked to supply a few of the jokes with which I have had the privilege of subverting the good taste of the Irish nation over the last few decades. And my own favorite Dublin joke, unquestionably, is not a joke at all, it's a true story, a true Dublin incident. Dublin, of course, being the very home of indignation. A Dublin man would rather be indignant than happy any day of the week. And the best example of this is the man who was cycling home for his lunch one day, and he was coming down past Tara Street Fire Brigade Station, and he saw men running around with hoses and shinning up and down ladders carrying out fire drills. So he got down off at the bike, and he looked on fairly approvingly at all this activity, until someone pulled a wrong lever, and a jet of water shot out of the hose, hit him in the chest, sent him spinning across the street, and left his bike in a tangled mass in the middle of the roadway. So he got up, wiped himself down, looked at the fireman and said, "Jesus, you wouldn't do it to me if I was on fire." And
My favourite Carrie story, of course, is the teacher who had two little boys from the same family, two brothers, obviously, from the same family, in his class, and he was very puzzled by the fact that they never arrived in school together. One was always a few minutes later than the other. And one morning, this puzzled him, but one morning when one of them actually came a little late, he was the first to arrive, but he was still a bit late, and he said, "You're late. What kept you?" He said, "I was having my breakfast." "Oh, I see. Must have been a fine breakfast to keep you late for school. What did you have for your breakfast?" "I had a boiled egg." "Oh, I see. All right, sit down. So 5 minutes later, the other brother arrived, and he said, "Oh, you decided to come to school. Very nice to have you with us. And tell me, what kept you? You're late." "I was having my breakfast." "I see. And what did you have for your breakfast?" "I had a boiled egg." "He said your brother had a boiled egg. He could be here 5 minutes ago." "Had I a spoon? Had I?" There were two men drinking in a New York bar, one at either end of this very, very long bar counter. And there was nobody else in the bar except the barman. And one guy squinted up along the length of the counter and said, "Do you know what? There's some shocking Irish looks about you." He said, "What's that effect?" "Well, you should get a prize for that. I have red hair and freckles and blue eyes and a broken nose, and you think I look Irish. Oh, Sherlock Holmes is alive and well and drinking in Manhattan." "There's no need to be so bloody sarcastic. I know damn well you were Irish." "What? I'm Irish myself, you know." "Jeez, you don't see, eh, you know. And what part of Ireland do you come from?" "It's none of your bloody business." "No, come on, where are you?" "I come from Mayo." "Come from Mayo? Jeez, I come from Mayo too. What part of Mayo do you come from?" "Culchamach, I suppose." "Culchamach, me arse. I come from Castlebar." "Jeez, I come from Castlebar too. What part of Castlebar do you come from?" And just then the phone rang and the barman picked it up and said, "Oh, hi, boss." No, it's very quiet. "Yeah, just the usual bullshit." "The Rowan twins are pissed again." Inevitably, if I stand up in public, people expect some reference to the County of Cavan. So we might as well get the poor hills out of the misery and start again. And there was a long-running dispute as to who would come out the winner in a contest of wits between the cute cock whore and the main Cavan bastards. And this was finally solved over a game of golf. Now, the result of the golf is immaterial, but it was played between a Corkman and a Cavanman, obviously. And when they came in, they went, leaving the 18th green, the Cavanman was sort of hurrying towards the locker room, and the Corkman said, "Hey, hold on, what's your hurry? You never paid your caddy. I mean, the caddy has to live too, you know, you have to." He said, "Oh, God, yeah, you're right." He said, "Well, you know, I left my wallet in the locker room. I'll tell you what, you fix up the caddy, and I'll fix up the Hughley later on. Is that all right?" "Okay, film up. So later on, the Corkman came out of the shawl with the towel around his belly, and the cabman said, Did you fix the caddies?" "Oh, I did. I gave you one for the 20 quid, and I gave you one for the 50p. "You give me for the 50p? "You might as well give him nothing and give him 50p. "Oh, no, because if I give him nothing, he might think you forgot. Now he knows you're a main bastard." All right, there's only two more. There's a habit among mothers in cities all over the world that on a Saturday they give their children something to help them with their movements through life. Some of them give them Glauber salts or Epsom salts, and they should all be put in prison. But there are others who give you things like California syrup of figs, from which we get the song, "California, here I come." Well, there was one mother in Belfast, and she favoured castor oil above all other remedies. She thought castor oil was terrific. It was sticking out, it was great, you know. So she used to give the little boy castor oil. But one morning she went looking for him. He was out in the street playing football. So she called him, Sammy! Sammy! Come on in and take castor oil. Well, not. Come in. I'm not coming in. I don't want her to hear it. I'm not coming in. She said, if you don't come in, come in and take your castor oil. I'm not coming in. I don't want her to hear it. If you don't come in and take your castor oil, I'll tell your father. You know what he'll do? He'll pace you around the house. So he will. Now you're coming, all right, I'm coming. Come on, come on, hurry up, and you're coming. All right, I'm coming. Are you going to take your castor oil? All right, I'll take my castor oil, but I won't shake. Finally, there were two men. There was petrol rationing. People don't remember this. But there was petrol rationing in this country not all that long ago, about 15 years ago, and the way it worked was that you drove up to a garage and they gave you a quid's worth, you know, and then you went on to another and you got topped up and so on. And it was a sort of barter in a way, because like you pulled up to it and you said, have you any petrol? Yeah, okay, I'll give you a quid's worth. And that's only because I don't allow your sister. She was any good, I'd give you 2 quid. But anyway, this sort of informal thing went on. But there were two men going down to Ballybunion from Dublin for a golfing holiday, and they were using this system to get down the country. They managed to get a pound's worth here, pound's worth there. They finally got over the Kerry border and they thought they were safe. But they finished up in this village absolutely bone dry, not a drop in the tank. And the driver got out and he went scouting around, and he finally came to this dilapidated looking pub with one dilapidated pump outside it. And he went in and he peered around in the gloom and the dinginess inside, and he saw a lady behind the counter knitting. She was an elderly lady, well, she was an old one. Anyway, he said, excuse me, he said, you have a petrol pump outside?
We have, that's right, yeah.
Well, he said, have you any petrol? No, we haven't a drop. But we'll have it in the morning, because they promised it, you know, the lorry about first thing in the morning. So if you're here in the morning, and of course you will be, because you know petrol to go anywhere else, we'll fill you up and you'll be grand. He said, well, that means we'd have to stay overnight. Oh, that's right, you figured that out very fast. Oh, the Dublin man for the brains, that's right, yes. Yes, we'd have to stay overnight. Well, he said, is there a hotel? Ah, what hotel do you want? We give you a bit of breakfast here, for heaven's sake. Good breakfast and lorry, you fix it up in the morning. So they stayed the night anyway, and they had the breakfast. They got the lorry arrived, and they got filled up, and they went on, and they had a good holiday. And about 3 months later, the man who had been driving the car came to his friend, and he had a letter in his hand, and he said, listen, do you remember when we had to stop overnight and get that petrol and carry in the dirty old pub? Oh, yeah, yeah, I do, yeah. And he said, now, tell me the truth. I want the truth now. He said, did you go to bed with that old one? He said, well, I did, yeah, I did. You did, you bastard. And you gave her my name and address. He said, I did, yeah, yeah. I'm sorry, I'm sorry. Well, he said, you're going to be more sorry now, because she died and left me the pub.
Thank you, God save you. Put it there, well done. Neil Tubby. Well, it is the last show. It is the last show. Well done, Neil. We'll take a break here. Come back to us after this.
Well done, Neil. God save you. Well done.
Thank you. Neil, come in.
Imagine if you could wash your skin so soft and smooth you could give up body lotion in 14 days. Day 1, the difference is already noticeable. Day 7, even the dry places are smooth. Day 14, your skin feels so soft and smooth, you could give up body lotion. And the name? Moisturizing Body Wash from Oil of Ulay. We can prove you could give up body lotion.
He uses call answering to take his calls when he's busy. So can you. To get this free service on your home phone, simply call 1-800-200-111 now.
Chocolate is Cadbury's, 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 chocolate is
checkmate. Can't be beaten.
You young pup, you cheated.
No, just can't be beaten.
Can't be beaten, you cheated.
Can't be beaten, and neither can Gay Byrne. A heartfelt thanks from us and all our customers for the last 38 years of wonderful entertainment and broadcasting, and the best of luck for the future. Here's to you, Gaybo. Super value, shopping as it should be.
Daydreamers at an all-night house, one where they don't, one made to roam. Reflections in a house of chrome.
It's the taste of Maxwell House that makes a house a home.
Well, a big, little big, your lovin' teddy bear.
Get your lucky mascot ready, because your favorite TV game show is back. With cash and a flash prizes of up to £10,000, trips to New York with me on the real Concorde, and the chance to be on the TV show, and win holidays, cars, and up to £250,000.
Fame and fortune is back, so get your teddy ready.
She uses call answering to take her calls when she's out. So can you.
Getting a lift, so you don't have to pick me up. Okay? Bye!
To get this free service on your home phone, simply call 1-800-200-111 now.
Cheery corn, cheery oats, cheery rice and wheat. Cheery four green Cheerios, cheery good to eat. They're nutritious and delicious, Cheerios so good to eat.
It takes four whole grains to make the one and only Cheerios.
Cheerios so good to eat.
And now, if you're nuts about honey, you love the great new taste of Honey Nut Cheerios. With smooth golden honey and roasted nuts, they're Cheerios so good.
Now, welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. I'm happy to report that since we started the show, I haven't looked at my watch once. And I don't care. Now, my next guest made his first appearance on The Late Late Show only 2 years ago, but he made a considerable impact. Now, when we first met him, I would have to say that he looked in very, very bad condition, extremely unhealthy, and in every way, rather unfortunately, bedraggled. And then when he came back, he was the picture of health and happiness. But after he left us, he was responsible for an amazing disappearing trick and an amazing story of intrigue and conspiracy, the likes of which I haven't encountered in a long, long time. We'd like him on the last Late Late Show to make a final appearance. Would you welcome, please, ladies and gentlemen, the chair. Shinne on Siokon. Kade Shin? That is the chair. The famous chair. So you know now that I was telling the truth last week when I told you that we know where the chair is and we know who has it. I'm reliably informed that henceforth it will be on show. What's the name of the pop-up that thing? Johnny Fox's. It'll be on show in Johnny Fox's pub. I don't know how and I don't know why, but apparently it will be on show in Johnny Fox's pub from here on. And there is attached to this a story of intrigue and romance and loyalty and love and betrayal and hatred. And I hope one day, when I have the time to sit down and I'll write a television folly and upper that will take us 6 months to get through at least. Take it away, Dennis. That's the chair, just to show you that. That's it. I can't tell you. I cannot tell you about the story. But I assure you, it is an extraordinary story. After which, I want to tell you that 2 years ago, we featured a company called Fragrance Boutique, located in Malahide. And the company, we're glad to say, arising out of enterprise and all of that sort of thing, has grown from 5 to 30 people manufacturing craft products. Have a look at that lovely thing. June the 1st, they're going to launch the Millennium Candle. There it is. It's non-drip, fire retardant, and as it burns, it illuminates each of 16 monumental events of the last 1,000 years. That's why it's called the Millennium Candle. And they are now getting orders for this candle from the Millennium Dome and Harrods in London, Bloomingdale's and Saks, Fifth Avenue, and 16 other countries. This Irish-designed candle looks like it's going to become a real world bestseller. And to celebrate the millennium, we have a lovely candle for you from Fragrance Boutique for everybody in the audience. So there you are. Take it home as a memento. As a memento of your visit to the final Late Late Show. Now, our next guest, ladies and gentlemen, has also been a guest on... VT, first of all, before I introduce... Thank you, Dennis. Just before I introduce our next guest, the VT clips that I told you about, Paul Reeves put them together. And, of course, down through the years, we had discussions about things, we had talks about things, and then we had ferocious rows about things. And when you look back at the apoplectic anger experienced by people discussing those things which were nearest and dearest to them, have a look at this selection. Roll it there, Ray, please.
How do you actually sort that problem out? Easy. Easy as far as John Boland's concerned. Try and make a few bob out of you, charge everybody who wants to apply for the job a tenner. That's the attitude of the government to the problem.
I make one little small
just answer the question. How big is your check?
I won't get it at all.
I've told you how big my check is.
You're big enough to employ a secretary to make sure your paperwork is correct. I have to do it after my day's work.
You take advantage of the vulnerable and the young to isolate them and brainwash them into believing that your system is somehow the only way of thinking or living.
PAYE people don't get abusive letters, they don't get harassment, they just get huge lumps of money that they shouldn't be paying.
That's out right.
Of
their,
and,
that's right.
And the answer to the problem for PAYE people is to put their affairs in order so as these things don't happen, and the same thing should apply to the self-employed.
Yes, their affairs are perfectly in order, and suddenly they get a demand for money that they do not owe.
And why do you think this is, Austin? Why?
Why? Because the bias shown by the tax inspectors is the explanation.
Absolutely. There was a murder or two in Malvern Street. The worthy explosion decided...
I'm sorry to interrupt, but I asked you to look forward instead of go back.
If you would just allow me, we presumably have some time.
I thought we could engage in some chit-chat.
Well, yes, we will, if you'd stop interrupting.
Yeah, well, I don't mind you interrupting me.
Well, I mind you interrupting me, frankly.
No patient, we are in... Why didn't we send in those men when the 5 Catholics died and not wait till 10 Protestants died to send us in 150 men? Why wait till then?
Sorry, you are at the moment saying that all of us are big booty men and not to leave a child alone with any of us that we could do some damage. That is a statement. That to me is a very unfair fascist statement.
And I'll tell you, it's been checked out.
We do not condone no veteran in this country condones drunk driving.
Are you going to give the jobs to the vets, the farriers, the saddlers, the livery men, the lorry men, the breeders, the fellows that do all the things that... And the tourists...
All of that. The horse industry is not dependent on despicable, unjustifiable cruelty to a small animal.
You're not listening to my point.
The people would allow the introduction of divorce, but they would not have this snowball effect, this mad galloping dash to have a divorce. Okay. I'm afraid that people like Alice Glenn have a very poor opinion of the Irish people. And in fact, they have a very low opinion of Irish marriage.
I'd like to hear, before this discussion finishes, something other than just the coalition view and the Fianna Fáil view, both of you whom are Thatcherite Regalite parties.
I believe we're doing very well in a lot of respects, and we shouldn't knock this country as much as we're known.
You think of an infant teacher, a junior infant teacher, with 25 little infants of 4 years old, which is a barbaric age for children to come to school in the first place. There should be proper childcare facilities for them, not school at 4 years old. You think of that. That means that if you go into a corner, as the new curriculum would suggest, and give 5 children 3 minutes of your time, you have 20 children pulling the ceiling down at the other end of the classroom.
Life is not the beating of a heart. The minimum, ideally, that you give a child is 2 parents to love it, a roof over its head, food and hope. And if you can't give it those things, then I submit with respect that the beating of its heart is meaningless.
Some more. some more of the exchanges we lived through down through the years. Now, my next guest has been a regular guest on The Late Show through the years. He has marked my career as I have marked his. I wrote the sleeve notes for his very first album long ago, and he has gone from strength to strength through the years and is a lovely, lovely performer. He left Ireland 50 years ago with a suitcase and his guitar, and since then, as they say, he's done well. Would you welcome, please, Mr. Val Dunican?
Thank you.
Val Dunican. Where are you, Val? Oh, there you are.
Thank you.
How lovely you look.
Thank you.
Isn't this splendid? There you are, Val. Great to see you.
Lovely.
Great to see you. Go over and sit down
there
on your stool.
Thank you.
Sit down on your stool. And that's the album. That's the album. Gaze, sleeve notes around that. It was a long sleeve note, wasn't it?
It was, and very, very complimentary, if I may say. Indeed, so very nice.
Well, it wasn't going to be insulting, was it? The lucky 13 shades of Val.
I look like John Boy out of the Waltons on there. Look at
How are you, me old friend?
I'm very well, mate. Very well indeed.
So you decided to chuck it then, but you're doing a little tour the last time you were on.
Oh, yes, I'm doing another tour over there. Yeah, I'm doing another tour. I'm doing about 40 concerts this year, yeah.
But at your own pace.
Absolutely, yeah. Yes. I'm doing laps of honour now. It's lovely.
Indeed.
I just work at my own pace, as you say.
And are you finding that fellas are forgetting who you are or anything?
Oh, I am. Do you know, some woman was telling me, she mentioned to the little girl next door that she was going to the concert hall to see Val Dunican, and the girl said, "Who's she?"
Val.
May I tell you a quick story?
Yes, do.
I mentioned that to Tom O'Connor, and Tom was telling me that he did a concert down in Wales recently, and it was at a local town hall, and it was Tom O'Connor and the Treorchy Male Voice Choir, you know, the Miners. And there was a young lad came in to do the sound and the lighting, and he was a bit of a whiz kid, you see, and he was very young, and he probably didn't know who Tom O'Connor was, but he came, and a few days before the concert, he rang the agent in London and said to him, "I'm doing your concert," he said, "on Sunday night, and I just want to ask you something." He said, "What exactly is the running order of the show?" So the agent said, "But there's no running order." He said, "The choir do the first half, and Mr. O'Connor does the second half, and that's it." And the kid said, "Well, what about the conjurer then?" And the agent said, "There's no conjurer. What are you talking about?" "Well," he said, "it's on the poster." "No, it's not," he said. "I sent the posters out." "What on earth are you talking about?" "Oh, it is," he said. He said, "Have you got a poster there?" And the kid says, "Yes, I have." "Read out for me," he said, "what's on the poster." Now, this is gospel truth. The poster read, "A gala evening of laughter and music starring Tom O'Connor and the Treorchy Male Voice Choir with the magic of Ivor Novello."
Where did he get it from? You can't be up to the...
Absolutely.
Can't be up to the
Absolutely.
One.
Absolutely. Ivan Ta-da!
Watercolours. You told us last time you were on, you were into watercolours.
I started... On my 70th birthday, I'm just turned 72 now, and on my 70th birthday, my wife bought me some watercolour lessons. I've always wanted to do it.
Another one, Pat.
I've got them all. I've got the old landscapes coming out now.
Yeah.
Great fun. It's wonderful.
Very,
if you haven't tried it, try it.
Very,
really
very good,
pal. Thanks ever
and
so
are
much.
And you're selling these now?
I'm not selling. I'm trying to give them out at concerts and that. You know.
Oh, really?
You
see, and they're signed by you and all.
And they are, lovely.
A little touch of Percy French about that, you know, all of that sort of thing.
I'm enjoying it so much, I can't tell you. It's just wonderful.
But you see, the great thing about you, Val, you're artistic.
I know.
That's the difference. You're artistic. You've always had artistry in you. You're going to sing a song.
I am indeed.
Roger is on the piano. Welcome
lovely
again,
to
Roger.
See you,
lovely to
thank
see you.
Thank you.
Welcome back.
You
well, you introduce it. Go
I
on
will.
To your.
You know, ladies and gentlemen, as I say, I've had the great pleasure of doing this job now since I left school. We're back in about 1945, 46. And I still can't believe, even though I've turned 72 now, that people are still asking me to do it and sit there and enjoy it. You know, it's quite amazing. It's the loveliest compliment that anybody could have. But then show business has always been full of surprises for me. And that's why I'm singing this particular little song. Thank you. Sometimes the snow comes down in June. Sometimes the sun goes round the moon. I see the laughter in your eyes. Sometimes it's all a big surprise. All of the times you came to me, when someone else had set you free,
I wondered what was right to do. I want to make it right with you. For there was a time when all I did was wish you'd tell me it was love. If not the way I'd hoped or how I'd planned, yet somehow it's enough. And now we're standing face to face. Isn't the world a crazy place? Just as I felt my chance had passed, you go and save the best to last. Yes, there was a time when all I did was wish you'd tell me it was love. If not the way I'd hoped or how I'd planned, yet somehow it's enough. And now we're standing face to face. Isn't this world a crazy place? Just when I thought my chance had passed, you've gone and saved the best for last. Just when I thought my chance had passed, you've gone and saved the best for last.
Well done, the Royal Standard. Thank you very much. God bless you. Well done. Val Doonican.
Thank you.
On tour. When is the tour starting? When is the tour starting?
August, September.
August, September. Well done.
Thanks ever so much. Thanks, everybody. Good night.
Thank you. Lovely performance. Lovely performance. Now, I want to have a word with Mick Grimes. Hello, Mick, and welcome back. Good evening to you. Mick Grimes, you met on the OMA show, ladies and gentlemen. And Mick lost his wife, daughter, and granddaughter in that, on that awful day in OMA. But you won a prize, Mick, isn't that right?
Yes, we won a prize, uh-huh.
You won a prize for what was the prize?
Well, it was two tickets for the...
For juries?
For juries, yes.
Aye. And you didn't go to juries?
No, I didn't. I didn't fancy going. No, I didn't go to juries.
So you put the tickets up for a raffle?
That's correct.
What did you get? What did you get for it?
We got £5,600.
Did you indeed? For the two tickets. £5,600. And was that Mick, now for the OMA fund, or did you send it somewhere else?
I sent it to Kosovo for the refugees.
Did you indeed? Well done. How are you, Mick, apart from that?
Oh, we're all right. No, nothing on earth will change the situation.
No.
And we have to live with it, and we will, and try and get along.
You're sleeping in?
Yes. Reasonably well.
And you're getting on with the job and all of that?
Yes, we're not long.
Well, the reason I asked you to come tonight is because after we closed the OMA fund on the Late Late Show, we collected all that money, but we closed it about 6 weeks ago, 2 months ago, but since then, the money kept on coming in, and we've come up with £11,000 more, which came in after we closed the fund. And so I wanted you to be here tonight to take the cheque for £11,000 and bring it back to your friends in OMA, for people of OMA, with our kind of...
Thank you very much.
And I visit OMA sometime during the summer. I'm coming to OMA because I'd like to go there. With or without prior notice, I'll be there anyway.
Thank
all right.
you.
God bless you, Mick. Thank you very much indeed. And convey our regards to the people, will you? Can you do that? convey our best regards and best wishes to the people. Will you do that? All right. Okay. Thank you. Now, I see Mairead McGuinness. Where is she up there? Where? There. Yes, yes, I see. Mairead McGuinness was also a researcher on The Late Late Show.
But I escaped early.
You escaped and 85, were
yeah.
you?
No, yes. I wasn't 85. It was in 1985 I was a researcher on The Late Late. I just aged to be about 85 when I worked with you.
Yes, indeed. But I always adored your RD accent.
But there's no way, Gay, I'm getting into that tonight, because the last time I did that, I'd had to leave town. Do you know I moved? I jumped the border into Meath, and I'm doing the Navan accent now, and they don't like it either. You brought that out in me, funnily enough, because I went through school. You brought a lot of things out of me, and I will tell all.
Yes.
I went through school mimicking teachers and having a great fun, and I have an uncle, Paddy, well, I don't have him anymore, he died a year ago, who farmed with us all our lives, and he had a brilliant RD accent and a marvellous wit. A man that would have a joke in his eye, and he'd look at a fella crooked, and I inherited that, I think it's genetic. But in the Late Late Show office, which I have to say I entered with great fear and trepidation, because I grew up on a diet of the Late Late, and I'm not bad on it actually either. We used to sit in on a Saturday night if it was good, and if it was bad we left. If there was a good row that we could bait each other up over, there was 11 of us around the table of a Sunday, so there would always be plenty of conversation, and we'd go out late. But when I bait a contract out of RTE in the 80s, and in those days, God knows, it was like that, and I was sent to the Late Late office, and Mary O'Sullivan introduced me to Gay Byrne, and you didn't even look up. You could be shocking sour, Gay. You could be shocking sour.
Maybe I didn't know what was
in store.
A horrid
cantankerous, too. Do you know what he said? He said, "We'll knock the corners off her," looking down his nose, and I sort of faded into a puddle on the floor and was scraped up afterwards. To do not so bad things, as it turned out, because there was a great bunch on the Late Late Show team, and they were all squashed into a matchbox, because the office was tiny then, that's and right. I don't really know if it got any bigger. But we all were, I was terrified of you, I have to say. And I'm not anymore, because this is live and I can go on a bit. I was really, really terrified, and we were all terrified. The rest of them won't admit it, but I must say I was, because I came from that background of watching you and being in awe of the whole show. So anytime you'd suggest an item, there'd be the nose factor. You'd know by the way Gay would hold his head whether he thought, Jesus, she's really talking through her at the moment, or maybe there's something in it. And it was a bit like Mike was saying, yeah, go on. And you sort of think, am I digging a hole here? Am I getting somewhere? And if you discovered any chink in what I thought was a good idea, God, you'd hammer into it and you'd crack it right open. And it was a great education for later. Because I look at stories now, and that's the business right. I'm in. With the eye that you have, that you've got to have a story, that people have to talk, and they've got to want to talk, some of them, and then if they don't want, you've got to drag it out of them.
Stop talking about
but
me.
Will you can I just tell you,
the RD accent? That's what I want to hear.
Can I tell you today, very, very traumatic around RD today. Gridlock, Main Street RD, there's always gridlock, Main Street RD.
Yes.
They were spreading slurry all day today in honour of the occasion. They're all in shock and mourning. Every farm in the place said, it's Gay's last late, get the slurry out so that we can get in for the night, which is true. But anyway, about the accent, I did it a few times in the Late Late.
You did.
And there was this one occasion, I overdid it in the Late Late, because a few of them, they're not talking to me since. Not even, they don't shake hands with me at Mass anymore either. But this little one knocked at my door after one of those great occasions on the Late Late, where you really think nobody's watching, and then you discover there's a few tuned in, and she rapped at the door early enough. And all she said was, "We don't talk like that here." So I said, "I'm not going to do that again for a while." Can I tell other things about you?
No. What's that?
You're not getting away with this.
What?
Because you battered me into knitting it for the Late. Colette will remember this. Can I stand up and
did you knit that?
That was called a tumbling blocks design by Kay Fassett, and you sneered down your nose at
No.
And you wouldn't even put it on. But Colette and I
yes.
had a book in the office by this designer called Kay Fassett, I think that's his name. And you said, knitting, not on your life and not on the Late Late. And Colette and I said, yes, it's going to be great. So I went home, bought 40 bowls of wool, two pairs of needles, and sat in the whole night. And he used to bring it dancing with me. And I finished it for the Late Late. And we got a man to knit, my friend Deirdre knit two little jumpers, and it worked. Thanks
be
to God, because
item.
If it failed, you could see, and Bridget will remember this in Colette, and you'd be watching the show on
that
the monitor
was the
outside.
Gay. Everything.
But we would watch you, and if we thought, oh, Jesus, it's not working, He'd be like a cantankerous bitter. You would. You could be shock and cross.
You're doing exactly the same thing now with your own publishing and your own newspaper and your own thing. So
but it's great to work with you. You knocked the corners off me.
You were lovely. Well done. The great McGinnis.
Can I say again?
Great little pullover.
This is going to be relics. Are being made of this as a token, and everyone in the audience is going to get one of these tumbling blocks after the show.
Don't threaten
well
us
done,
like that.
Well done.
Thank you, Mary. Okay. Now, I have to tell you that I was at a concert with Peter O'Brien, music and song and all sorts of things in the concert hall about 6 weeks ago, and Rosalie Linehan did this particular act, and I asked her very, very specially on the Late Late Show, would she do it for me? Would you welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, Rosalie Linehan over here. Thank you.
A middle-aged, middle-class lady who's got the middle-aged, middle-class blues. I'm just a middle-aged, lonely lady who's got problems. Here's my news. The days stretch out ahead of me. No wonder I feel low. The housework and the shopping, the washing up and oh, the Valium, my mother, and now life without cable. I've got the middle-aged, middle-class blues. Oh God, the hair needs another color. I hate going to that hairdresser's. It's full of teeny boppers and loud music. Last week a terrible thing happened to me. I was waiting at the base and waiting to get my hair washed. And my girl shouted over to the young one, Charlene, would you wash my lady for me, please? And the young one shouted back, which one is she, Elaine? What age is she? And do you know what she said? Somewhere between 40 and dead. I'm just a middle-aged, middle-class lady who's got the middle-aged, middle-class blues. I've got a middle-aged, dreary husband, and one day I'll blow my fuse. His eyesight's gone, his hair, his teeth, the hearing's not too great. A grunt is all I get when I try to communicate. I slipped him some Viagra, but it was 15 years too late. I've got no middle-aged, middle-class. Last week it was my birthday, and I said to him, what do you think they're getting me for my birthday? And he said, I don't know. Anything particular in mind? And I said, no, nothing in particular. Just like to see the occasion marked, you know? Oh, he said, if you've nothing particular in mind, I was thinking of getting you a gift token for a weekend in St. John of God's. I'm just a middle-aged, middle-class lady who's got the middle-aged, middle-class blues. I've got a muddle-headed doctor told me some activity to choose. I tried to take an interest, took a course in manicure. Then I acted Lady Bountiful to the deserving poor. I tried the charismatic movement, gin and acting like a whore. And I still got those middle-aged, middle-class men. I don't know where my generation went wrong, really. I think, looking back on it, I think a lot of you will agree that we ploughed too much of our own lives into our children. Many of you feel like that. I think I spent about 16 years on the floor with Lego and stickle bricks and dinky cars. Dinky cars. I could do a PhD in dinky cars. You see, I was trying to get rid of their repressions, open them out, not be like us, you know. I mean, no sex before marriage, diddly die afterwards, you know. going to confession every week to the priest, all that guilt, you know, telling them everything. To looking back, half of them were doing twice as much as we were. I look at my kids now, you know, they're bonking everything in sight. 3 holidays a year. My kids think confession is a Calvin Klein aftershave. Oh, girls, we were the last of the gobshites. Oh, I'm just a middle-aged, middle-class lady. You've got the middle-aged, middle-class blue. I've got a middle-sized family who drive our lady to the moon. My son just lies in bed all day and smokes, well, what God knows. My daughter's got 10 earrings through her navel, tits and toes. The other son looks just like me, now he's wearing all my clothes. I've got the middle class. Give your thumbs a twiddle class.
Thank you, my darling. Well done. Great. Thank you, Peter. Thank you, Peter. Video. Wonderful. Rosalie Linehan.
I thought you might enjoy that a little bit. Rosalie Linehan, and that was Peter O'Brien, Professor Peter O'Brien, on the piano. Some more video memories through the years. Roll it, Ray.
Can it be that it was all so simple then? Or has time rewritten every line? And if we had the chance to do it all again, tell me, would we? Could we? Memories like the corners of my mind, misty watercolor memories of the way we were. Scattered pictures of the smiles we left behind, smiles we gave to one another for the way we were. Time rewritten every line. And if we had the chance to do it all again, tell me, would we? Too painful to remember. We simply choose to forget. So with the laughter, we will remember. With anger, we
music. That was my hero. Just at the end there. My hero, Eamon Andrews, Lord rest him, who really started it all. Now, as you know, ladies and gentlemen, down through the years, we've had many, introduced many groups, many performers who have gone on to greater things, as I said earlier on. And one of the most outstanding are record breakers by any standards worldwide. And I'm pleased to welcome just two old friends who wanted to come along and join us tonight on the Late Late Show. Would you welcome, please, Larry and Bono? Here we are. Ah, he's coming in on his book. Coming in on the low device. There you are. Ho, 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 ho. Well done. Wow. How's about that then? Well, welcome, sir. Welcome, sir. Welcome, Larry. What are you at, Larry?
How are you doing?
Heaven's sake. How are you doing? Is that the new one?
That's the new one.
That's the new one.
Brand
new. How long have you got that one?
About 3 hours.
3 hours?
Yeah.
3 hours, really?
Yeah.
That is beautiful.
Yeah.
Well done.
Yeah.
Well done.
Do you remember about 3-4 years ago at Sutton Cross?
Yes.
I was there. I was
yes.
on my Harley.
Yes.
Looking very cool.
Yes. Very cool.
And this car pulled up beside me. It was a very battered limousine. All right, and
Paul won't be pleased about
no,
that.
No, it was a bit shady, but
yes.
the window went down and you stuck yes. your head out and you said, excuse me, what sort of a bike is that? And I turned around and I saw you and said, it's a motorbike, Gay. and you said, I love those bikes. He said, you know what, when I was a young fella, I used
That's
to
right.
ride around all the time. You had
That's
Kathleen
right.
in the sidecar and it was great.
Well, no, not quite that. No, not quite that, but I won't.
So, Gay, this is from us to you, as a gift.
From who?
From you. From you two to you.
Come on. My God. You're having me on now. This is a guy.
That is pretty good.
I would be frightened out of my life to take off on that. Bono.
No, you wouldn't.
Speak.
No, this is
you're supposed to sing a song, you just do a number.
This is you're the wild one. And that's about as wild as it.
That's about as wild as you can get. Come on, I can't cope with this. Don't be ridiculous. Oh, yeah, I know, Charlie.
Well, there isn't well, one Charlie. For everyone in the
no,
audience.
There is.
Belongs to Gay.
Not one of these. There isn't one for everybody in the audience. That is ridiculous.
So that's anyway, yours.
I'm quite sure you're gagging, but thank you for the lovely thought anyway. Well done.
No, we're actually serious.
We are actually serious.
It's a very Elvis thing of us to do, isn't it, really?
A very. I'm just, I can't cope with this.
Well, now we've just got to helicopter ourselves, and Sam and I'm just going back for another 4 years. Back on the line, it'd be great.
This is too much. So what is she? She's a twin, and she's air-cooled. And,
she's very fast, Gabe.
She's very fast, yes. Yeah.
She's very fast,
yeah,
and she's free
yeah.
to you.
Yeah. Yeah. Fantastic. The nearest I got to them so far is a beautiful book somebody gave me years ago, full of all the details of them. And I look at it now and then, but I never thought I'd see it. Listen, this is ridiculous. Come here. You're going to sing a song. What's happening in your life? I have to recover myself. I have to recover myself.
I'm delighted.
Please,
we've caught him.
Just a speech.
We can't. The funny thing is, I actually remember going out to Howth on a very different occasion because I had my old man said to me when I was 17, he said, look, you're either going to have to get a job or get this band off the ground. And if it's not happening, you got to get out of the house. You're going to have to pay your way. So we were really stuck. And I just knew, I just knew if we got on the Late Late Show, that would sort out the problems. And I had visions of, you know, the Beatles with Ed Sullivan and stuff. And Larry knew somebody who knew somebody who knew Tony Boland, who I think is here.
Here he is, second
there
row.
There you go. Who's,
beside
Paddy. You know, who's working as a producer and a search and whatever. So Larry was put in charge of actually getting us the gig on the Late Late Show. So. You called, didn't you? I think.
Yeah, Tony, I'm sorry. I know I called every day for 3 months, and
this is true.
It is true, and Bono will continue the story because
it didn't really
help.
Come off.
No, Tony.
Tony got us the gig, and then
You threw us off the show, okay?
And that was very messy, you know. And so I dealt with it the worst. And in fact, I actually decided to go out to Hoth and kill you. And Ali was with me, and she said, you can't do that. And I said, I know his replacement is going to get us on the show. Let's just take him out. And got the double-decker out to Hoth.
This is honestly the truth.
Myself, yeah. And I said, like, I know. And she said, this is a big mistake. And I said, I know, if he sees genius up close, he'll recognize it. And so we went out to Hoth, double-decker out to Hoth, the single-decker, the one that goes just round the head. And I got on the ADAs, I got on the bus, and I said, look, I'm looking for Gay Byrne's house, you know, and he said, yeah, right. Gay Byrne's house, I'm going to tell you where Gay lives. I said, no, I'm serious, you don't understand, I have an important meeting with Mr. Byrne.
I'm a genius.
And I'm actually going to grow up and be Bono, and our group, you two, is just going to be in your face, and really, you should really tell us where Gay lives. And he goes, okay, this is the house, there you go, off you go. So I went up. And Ali is still going, this is a real mistake. And I went up, I think it's a blue door. And I'm really embarrassed to tell you. I mean, this is sad, really. And I went up, and I was just about to knock on the door. And an overpowering feeling came over me. I recognized it. I haven't had it many times. I remember it from the back fields of Ballymun when faced with skinhead gangs in the 70s carrying saws and Black and Decker drills. It was actual terror. Fear. Yeah. And I walked away and I didn't say anything. Ali didn't say anything. We just kind of went up and we just stood on the road. Bus pulled up, got on the bus.
Ah, oh, you did.
The same bus, the same driver.
And he said,
short meeting. Short meeting. I said, it was a very short meeting.
Oh, I'm sorry. There is now.
Oh, dear, oh, dear. If I'd known you were going to give me a Harley-Davidson, I would have come to the door, really.
Well, and what is there now? What are you at as we speak? You're going to sing for us, but what are you working on?
I wasn't planning on singing. I thought the bike would be enough.
No, you got to sing. Sitting on the bike, coming in or going out, you still got to sing.
Gosh. Okay. I can imagine a tune where you have to be really quiet. If I could, actually, just if you could lower the lights, maybe. This is a tune, but this is a really popular tune. I think everyone will know it. It goes, I've got a microphone. Oh, I'm on a microphone. Okay.
You're on a microphone.
I should know this.
Okay.
Okay, could you all just please join in if you know what I'm talking about? Ba da ba da ba ba da ba da ba ba da 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 da. To whom it may concern, Gay Byrne.
Thank you very much indeed. I'll get over this gag one way later. Well done, Larry. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Dennis, you'll explain this gag to me, I know, later on sometime. I'm slow tonight. It's been a long day, and I'm not cottoned onto it yet, but you'll explain to me. But it's a lovely motorbike, and we'll take a break, and we'll try to sort it out then. And would you be careful when you move that bike, and don't let anything happen to it. Okay, we'll take a commercial break. Come back to us after this, because I don't forget this one.
You know, the simplest ideas are often the best. Like this one. New Surf tablets with Soda Bright to boost your whites. No mess, no fuss. Great surf performance and great value too. So go on, give them a whirl.
But seriously, let's dispense with the cheap sentimentality for the moment, okay?
Wake up!
The millennium is nearly upon us, and now's the time for a little experimentation.
Since you've all been so very lovely, and I've come to think of you as my
friends, I have something special for you. New, different, golden,
smooth as an illicit kiss.
So come on, it's not like I'm asking you to
sell your doll.
Drink the beer.
Last orders at the bar.
Every time we say goodbye, I die a little.
To get ahead of Brendan, you have to be up early. He's part of our local sourcing team. Up and out with the lark, listening, learning, looking for the finest and freshest locally produced foods. Brendan is part of our team, but he works for you, putting more of Ireland's best products where you want to see them, on our shelves.
Everything okay, madam?
Go Ireland. Every little helps.
Have you had your Weetabix?
It's no time to make a change. Just relax, take it easy.
Colm! What have you been up to?
I thought something was brewing. You're a star.
Extra quality, extra flavor. Lion's the quality tea.
Remember the new boss and her hubby are coming around.
Hello, 7 o'clock.
I'll stop off and get some wine so they may be here before.
Great, and what am I supposed to do with them? Show them the wedding video?
It's a great idea. It's in my car. Just make sure it's the wedding day and not the wedding night.
Mm-hmm.
Me, Taza.
Are you Jane, more like?
It couldn't be easier with Speakeasy from ESAT Digiphone. You pay for your calls in advance, so there's no bills. And whether you choose to be an early bird or a night owl, you can have cheaper calls when you want them. Speakeasy. Just pay and speak.
Welcome back. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Our next guest is on a world tour at the moment, and during the week she did three absolute sell-out concerts in Dublin, but because of the special day that's in it and the special night that's in it and the special show is in it, we asked her if she would stay over and just join us very briefly. Would you welcome, please, Sarah Brightman.
Per strada.
Well done. Thank you. Thank you very much. Lovely. Beautiful. Beautiful indeed. Sarah Brightman, and she's off first thing on an early flight to Amsterdam for a concert there tomorrow night. And we were delighted to have her with us. And I'm delighted to say that another very, very favourite lady of mine has been at a function earlier on tonight, but she's just taking a few minutes on the way home to pop in and say hello to us all. Would you welcome, please, Uachtaráin na hÉireann, Mary McAleese, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome. Uachtaráin, hello.
How are you? How are you bearing it?
I'm grand. And how are you?
Very bad, thank you. Very bad.
You're the best, are you?
Yeah, well, I've just had an awful job for the last 5 minutes. You won't believe what I've spent the last 5 minutes doing. You thought the bike was a joke, didn't you?
Yes, I did.
Well, I've been in the dressing room squeezing Kathleen Watkins into her black leathers. And there's a matching set for you. You're both going home to host tonight in style.
Whether we like it or not.
Whether you like it or not.
Well, you were out all day, presumably officiating and all of that.
I was in the house actually quite a bit of today. I was out this morning opening a centre for autistic children in a school in St. Bridges and Finglas. And then in the afternoon we had a garden party in the Arras, which was a complete panic. We had all of the Special Olympics team. And it was just fantastic. Well, they danced the afternoon away. It was wonderful. Great fun.
And then what? You were at something this evening.
Then we had dinner, and then I'm here.
Yeah, well, you're very, very
so the night
good
is yet young.
So you better explain to them why you're here.
Well, why I'm here?
Yes.
Well, to follow the song, I was just thinking, actually, as Sarah was singing, you know, that you're holding up very well, you're bearing up very well, but all over the country, when people hear that song, which was so appropriate for tonight, there are people who are sitting crying, you know, tonight. Yes. They are. They're very deeply sad. Mm. And I was thinking of all the people I know that have written to you, they've emailed, they've phoned, they've sent letters, and then, but there are a lot of people still trying to get through, and I thought I'd just come here tonight and say thank you on behalf of all of us. Just a very simple thank you.
Thank you. That's very kind of you. Very kind of you. Thank you. But what are your memories of the show?
You've entertained us. You have educated us, you've exasperated us,
yes,
and you've provoked us.
And you have guested on it.
And I've guested on it many a time.
It, yes.
And what more can anybody ask over 37 years? I think I have a lot of memories of the show, but I think, leaving aside the memories, because everybody has their own pocket of memories, it's just the sheer brilliance of being able to do this week in, week out for 37 years. It's extraordinary. And to be able to hold an audience for that length of time, which spans a lot of generations. I mean, most of the audience here are involved in one way or another in television, so they know, and I know a little bit about what it's like to be a live broadcaster. I had a very short career as a live broadcaster, short enough to traumatize me for the rest of my life, because anybody who's ever been involved in live broadcasting knows that you spend your time in a state of controlled hysteria at best. And it calls for nerves of absolute steel. And you could do it for a while, but to do it for 37 years is just unbelievable. And to be able to hold a live show of this length, primetime television, week in, week out, dealing with the kind of range of guests, moving from entertainment to pathos, moving from stories of real, you know, just human awfulness, tragedy, to humour the next. It's, well, you don't know, but the rest of us who observe, you know, just how extraordinary a genius that calls for. And I think one of the great things that I take pride in is that so many other television channels have tried to imitate this show, and they've tried and they failed. And no one but RTE and no one but you has been able to do it so successfully for this length of time. And I think it is. It's a source of national pride to us that in this place
there
we've been
are
able to do it.
There you are. But the time has come. The time has come, Uachtaráin, and all things must end. So
what I'm trying to figure now is, for years in our house, the Late Late Show was the night you got the takeaway, you bought the somebody was sent for the bag of marshmallows, the Coke, the crisps, all the junk food. We would sit down, and for the 2 hours, you would watch the programme. and you brought in the Chinese takeaway or the fish and chips. And all that was part and then the next day, every day, then every Saturday or Sunday would start with,
did you watch the show last night?
And even if you hadn't seen it, by the end of the week you thought you had seen it because so many people had felt obliged to tell you blow by blow, word for word, and it always lasted far longer than the 2 hours conversation,
absolutely.
I can tell you.
And what were they at again? And what was he doing? And what does he think he's doing?
I know, and I mean, many's around in our house started that way. Did you watch the Late Late Show last night? And I always think you're a great buffer because my mother's great defence always was, well, I mean, it wasn't I who said it. It was Gay, or it was somebody on Gay's show who said it.
Yes.
So it was great. It was great to have somebody else to blame.
That's right.
It was great, and you did that. I mean, in a way, you were the buffer. So many conversations were able to be. You were able to explore things in the house around the dinner table that you mightn't have been able to explore otherwise because you'd raised them on the show here, and you were able to kind of, you know, instead of quoting yourself or what you were feeling, well, it was somebody on Gay's show said it, or Gay himself said it.
But tell me this, did you really not like television very much, working in it, I mean?
Oh, I loved it.
I
loved the teamwork, I loved the camaraderie.
Yes.
Live television, I couldn't say I loved. No, I didn't. I was petrified of it.
No. But you went on to greater things, didn't you? I mean,
I went on to other things anyway, whatever about greater things I went on. It was a good training. It was a very good training, live television, for all sorts of things.
Yes, yeah. By golly, and it's standing to you still because you can address a crowd, you can get up and do your thing, and want no bother to you.
That's exactly
no
right. Nothing would ever frighten you again after you. After you have actually faced what you know is your mother, whatever about the rest of the audience being live, the one that really frightens you, in my case anyway, was my mother. Because she was usually the first person on the phone after the show saying, did you have to wear that old red jacket again? Have you nothing else to wear?
All
I should be at it again tonight.
All great fun. Ugtaran, thank you very much indeed for coming. You're
thank
very,
you,
very
Gay.
Good.
Thank
I'm
you.
So grateful to
thank
you.
You.
I know you've had a long day.
God bless
Goodbye
you. Take
and
care.
Thank you.
Enjoy.
Okay.
Enjoy the bike.
We will. Enjoy the bike. I have to cope with that yet. God bless you and thank you very
you
much.
You can ride it, can you?
Oh, I can. Oh, I certainly can. Goodbye to you and thank you. Ugtaran the heron, what? Okay, now I have some news to tell you, ladies and gentlemen. That was Ugtaran Meheran, and we're extremely grateful to her for coming in on the way by after a long, long day. And I have to tell you that I've been lying again tonight, all the time I've been lying, because it is indeed my darling Meryl Streep in the Jigsaw, which we were doing all through the various commercial breaks. And the first one to guess it was... Charlie Bird. And Charlie, the final indignity has come your way.
Oh, good God.
The final example of naffness is now about to happen to you. The final time when you'll never be able to interview anybody or do a report again because they'll point the finger and say, Late Late Show Jigsaw, you won a prize, oh, Charlie. Geez. Yes, you did. Don't swear on the Late Late Show, please.
Sorry, I apologise. I said fuck it. Oh.
You have won a prize of a holiday for two to Florida. Budget travel. In this office. Budget travel. Our friends at Budget Travel are taking you and your darling wife, well, make your own arrangements, to Florida.
Thank you.
And you will stay there for a fortnight. And not only that, but the great thing about it is flights and accommodation, car hire laid on, all of that sort of thing. But you'll also have, believe it or not, a VIP trip to the Universal Studios.
Oh, God.
And so help me God.
To meet Meryl Streep.